Good afternoon, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to NBS Business Conference 2022. My name is Brenna Varian, a second-year student from Nanyang Business School, and I am pleased to be your MC for this afternoon. To start off this afternoon's program, it is my honor to invite Professor Christina Soh, NTU Vice President for Strategy and Leadership Development and Dean of Nanyang Business School, to deliver her welcome address. Professor Soh, please.
Good afternoon, distinguished guests, esteemed corporate partners, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our beautiful NTU campus. It is indeed a pleasure to see you here today in person for our inaugural NBS Business Conference 2022, held as part of NBS's Partner Day and in conjunction with NTU's 30th anniversary. I'm told that there are many more tuning in online. Welcome also to you, and thank you all for your support. As a business school in a leading technological university, I believe that we are particularly well placed to discuss and tackle the key issues facing businesses now. One of these pressing issues is sustainability, and our discussions later this afternoon will focus on the theme of this event, Leading Global Business and Corporate Sustainability with Impact. Many of you might be aware that in October last year, NTU announced its Sustainability Manifesto, which will propel the university's wide-ranging sustainability efforts over the next 15 years. This manifesto strives to attain carbon neutrality with a 50% reduction in carbon emissions by 2035. In line with NTU's commitment to decarbonisation and sustainable development, NBS has also been placing greater emphasis on sustainability across all aspects of what the school does. Now, a key focus of NBS will be in the area of talent development. As a business school, while we facilitate learning on the business, scientific, technological, and social aspects of sustainability, our ultimate goal is to cultivate leaders who can incorporate sustainable development into strategy and implementation. To this end, sustainability is now embedded across our curriculum. At the undergraduate level, we offer students the option of an interdisciplinary major or minor in sustainability. Students can also choose from up to 200 sustainability-related courses throughout the university. Our postgraduate course students will benefit from our MBA sustainability track, which includes modules such as climate science, renewable energy taught by our colleagues in science and engineering faculties, sustainable finance, green marketing, and so on. Further, beyond the degree programs, we're also supporting the professional business community in the areas of corporate sustainability and sustainable finance. So I'm pleased to announce today the launch of two new executive education programs. First is the Executive Certificate in Corporate and Environmental Sustainability, which will see us, for the first time, bringing together leading academics and industry experts from PwC, Willis Towers Watson, and the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, for a 9-day program to help managers prepare their organizations for a sustainable future. The second program is the Certificate Program in Sustainable Finance, offered in collaboration with the United Nations Global Compact Network, Singapore. This program will delve more into the details of green and sustainable finance, and it will involve our leading finance faculty and industry leaders who are very well versed in these topics. The launch of these two programs is timely, as the threat of climate change has made companies realize the importance of adopting more sustainable and socially responsible business practices. The courses will also be aligned with the move by Singapore Exchange, requiring companies to provide various climate-related disclosures from the next financial year to improve corporate accountability. Beyond the classroom, our commitment to sustainability is also evident in the efforts and achievements of our students. For example, last year, we hosted the Shell NTU InterVarsity Debate, which brought together students from various disciplines across the many universities in Singapore. The students engaged in debates on issues around especially the topic of energy transition. Across the year, our own NBS students at both undergraduate and postgraduate levels participate in many sustainability-themed events and competitions. And I must say I'm proud that our students perform very well, many times taking home the winner's trophy. We've also taken steps to contribute to sustainability beyond education, also very important in the other pillar of a business school, which is research. And I think our research has two particular distinctives. It is interdisciplinary and it's highly industry engaged and driven. One example would be NTU's partnership with Enterprise Singapore in establishing the Singapore Agri-Food Innovation Lab, or SAIL for short, last November. Food sustainability is clearly very critical, and SAIL aims to drive innovation and collaboration among companies in the agri-food sector and bring more developments from the lab to market. NBS plays a key role in SAIL, together with many of you who are our longtime partners, co-leading the center and contributing actively with our colleagues in food science and engineering, offering expertise in areas such as food tech, agritech, and microbiology. Another second significant industry collaboration is GAIP, or the Global Asia Insurance Partnership. Now, this is the result of years of work and partnership between NBS's Insurance and Finance Research Center, global insurance companies, and regional regulators, especially MAS. GAIP is a platform to pool our collective resources and expertise to tackle strategic risks and industry-wide issues. One of the first areas that our industry partners have tasked us to work on with them is climate-related risk assessment and financing options. Another area is our Center for Business Sustainability, which has been set up to create greater awareness about corporate sustainability and socially responsible business operations, as well as to facilitate interdisciplinary research in these areas. Finally, later today, our Asian Business Case Center, which is almost two decades old, will launch their casebook called Towards a Sustainable Future. This casebook will showcase businesses that have successfully incorporated sustainability into goals and processes. Our faculty work closely with the 8 organizations in this casebook, charting and following their sustainability journeys to deliver positive economic, environmental, and social impact. For us, this is also our contribution to the wider educational community as we see these cases being used in other institutes of higher learning around the world. Today's event gives us the opportunity to dive deeper into corporate sustainability. We have an outstanding lineup of speakers, prominent industry leaders, corporate partners, and top academics from NBS and NTU. I believe that you will be having a meaningful and thought-provoking afternoon. In closing, let me highlight that this event, as part of our NBS Partners Day, is meant to express our appreciation to important corporate partners whose generous contributions of your time and funds have been instrumental to the success of our research centres and programmes. In fact, this event is the joint effort of the various centres, research centres in the Nanyang Business School, including the Centre for Excellence in International Trading, the Centre for Business Sustainability, Centre for African Studies, the Information Management Research Centre, the Insurance Risk and Finance Research Centre, and the Asian Business Case Centre. For the first time, these various research centres have come together to jointly organise this conference to give back to our corporate partners. Before I end, we have put together this video to show our appreciation to all our corporate partners. Please do enjoy this video. Thank you.
On behalf of our various research centres in NBS, and in particular, the Information Management Research Centre, or IMARC for short, I would like to convey our deepest appreciation and thanks to our partners for supporting us in so many ways. the research centres in NBS pride ourselves in the thought leadership and the research we conduct, which contribute to addressing important and complex problems faced by the industry and various organisations.
Congratulations to NTU on your 30th anniversary. Enterprise Singapore and Nanyang Business School have worked closely since 2015, driving various initiatives for the trading sector. These include the International Trading Program, the Nanyang Professional MBA in International Trading, and more recently, the Singapore Agri-Food Innovation Lab.
The Centres of Excellence in International Trading, CEIT, was established about 8 years ago with the support of 8 corporate partners. Today, that number has grown to more than 40. You, our corporate partners, have been instrumental in the success of the Centre and the International Trading Program. You have provided our students with industry learning experiences through internships, brought the industry into the classroom with your seminars, and helped us with making the program always relevant.
Congratulations, NTU, for 30 years of significant contribution to tertiary education in Singapore. The Singapore Accountancy Commission is proud to have partnered the Nanyang Business School in developing the Chartered Valuer and Appraiser Program, or the CVA program in short, since its inception in 2013.
The NTU SBF Centre for African Studies is here because of the generous support of its corporate partners. Our work delivers world-class research, fosters networks, and builds the capacity to do business with Africa.
It has been a pleasure to partner with Nanyang Business School for more than 10 years since 2011. We began our journey with NBS and started Insurance Risk and Finance Research Centre, taking on several projects, and most notably Siren project, which was very well received by regulator, insurance industry, as well as small medium enterprises. Moving on, SCORE continued to partner with NBS along with Monetary Authority of Singapore in their latest venture, Global Asia Insurance Partnership.
I would like to take this opportunity expressing my deep gratitude to our partners. In particular, the centre would not have been established without the generous seed funding from SCORE Reinsurance. My appreciation also goes out to MAS and to our other corporate benefactor of the centre, who have provided not just funding, but their time and expertise to build capabilities.
Business China is pleased to be a partner of NTU since 2012, when we curated and launched Business China's flagship Advanced Leaders Programme. As we join and celebrate NTU's 30th anniversary, we sincerely wish NTU all the very best in your future endeavours, and may the partnership between both organisations continue to flourish in years to come.
It has been our pleasure to partner with Nanyang Business School on various upskilling and research initiatives over the past year. We will look forward to strengthening our partnership with Nanyang Business School to further drive continuous learning and advanced thought leadership in HR.
Thank you, Professor Soh. We would now like to invite our eminent keynote speaker, Mr. Lim Chow Kiat, Chief Executive Officer of GIC Singapore, to deliver the keynote on investing with purpose and responsibility on stage. Mr. Lim, please.
Good afternoon. Thank you for this opportunity to speak at this inaugural business conference of MBS. It's been almost 30 years since I left MBS. It's great to be back. And congratulations to see so many partnerships that we have forged and so many achievements that we have made. I also serve on the board of NTU, so it's really gratifying to see that MBS has gone a long way. And for today, in fact, to pick this topic of business sustainability as something that we like to forge, we like to build with the business community going forward. And in particular, as Christina said, to build the talent pool, which is, I would say, badly needed by many companies and employers in Singapore. So the topic of my speech today is investing with purpose and responsibility. But given the uncertain times we are in today, I will add a little bit to it, right? With the word in a world in transition. Uncertain time it is. It has been actually less than 3 weeks since the most recent seismic event that we saw in Europe, 24th Feb 2022, will live its mark in the memories of most people. We will ask, what were you doing on that day? Just like we have asked, what were you doing on the day of 9/11, the failure of Lehman Brothers, and the Wuhan lockdown? By the way, I was actually flying over the North Pole on that day, making my way from Singapore to New York and then Washington, D.C. And I had, of course, access to in-flight Wi-Fi. That was a mistake. Then you see the news of something like that happen. Let me set the context of my sharing through the lens of GIC's purpose and responsibility. For 40 years, GIC has been tasked to preserve and enhance the international purchasing power of the reserves under our management over the long term. That's a mantra that we preach in GIC, that I expect all my staff to be able to recite, even if they are woken up at 3 a.m. in the morning. GIC's purpose is to be a three-in-one fund for Singapore, to be a rainy day fund, to be a stability fund, and to be the endowment fund for Singapore. Ultimately, of course, it is to secure the financial future of the country. We take that seriously, of course, but beyond Singapore, in more than 40 countries, GIC has significant impacts on our investee companies as well as communities. And we take that seriously too by supporting sustainable business practices. Our goal is sustainable profitability. In line with Adam Smith's invisible hand, guided by a broader set of values to look after the interests of a wider group of stakeholders beyond just maximizing shareholder wealth. This is in a bit of a contrast to Milton Friedman's interpretation, which is really focused on shareholder maximization. Now, the bottom line really is to have a bigger pie for all over the long term. Now, with that, I'd like to share some comments, sort of zooming out a little bit beyond just sustainability, on how the world is on the move. We are experiencing big changes, some in short order, like the tragic Russia-Ukraine war, best captured, of all people, by Lenin's quote, where he said, "There are decades where nothing happens, and there are weeks where decades happen." We just witnessed one. Now, some changes take longer, but they are no less impactful. I'll go through briefly five of these big trends, which ought to really percolate on our mind. The first, of course, is pandemic. We're not out of that yet. The COVID situation remains uneven globally, spanning the full spectrum of pandemic, and in some places, episodic kind of epidemic, and countries trying to normalize endemic living conditions, with all the attendant difficulties and measures which we are all very familiar with now. Beyond short-term prospects, we are concerned about long-term scarrings. akin to long COVID and its impact on social, political, and economic health. Public health outcomes and policy choices or responses have long-term consequences. For example, the ballooning public debts in some countries resulting from government stimulus, the loss of education from school shutdowns, the greater inequality due to different healthcare access, employment trends from policy choices, right? Whether you choose to protect jobs or you choose to protect employees, that has big consequences. For example, in the US, we see the Great Resignation, at least partly due to the fact that the policy choice was one of directly helping workers. So these all have long-term consequences, including, of course, also the sectoral differences, depending on the help packages they get from their governments. Now, not everything is bad. There are clear opportunities, including the advancement, for example, in mRNA technology that could be put to other use beyond COVID, increased public-private sector collaborations in various fields. We have seen examples of those. Acceleration of digitalization, that's powerful, right? That certainly for the business world is one of the most important developments in the last few years. And certainly for some countries, the supply chain realignment. There are winners and losers. Places like Vietnam, places like Mexico are clear winners. Some places, they lost out. So pandemic is the first thing that we still have to pay attention to. The second is the big thing of what people call order, right? Or international order. The wall in Europe is a sad human tragedy. It also brings geopolitical and other strategic consideration back to the top of the agendas, which we could ignore for a number of years, but no longer. Order, or the norms or and institutions governing interactions, underpins the functioning of economies and markets. It's a foundational issue. We are seeing military conflicts, but also weaponization of trade, finance, internet, and other things. For investors and businesses, this is no doubt a big concern. Great power rivalries are back due to the structural change in global power distribution. We're now moving from a single pole to multi-poles. That brings in a lot of competition and tension because fundamentally, there's just a lack of trust. And it's a difficult issue to deal with. Domestic order, too, has frayed. On the back of the stagnation of the middle-income class in many developed countries, there is simply a lack of common purpose. All these have resulted in higher political risks domestically as well as across countries, which all businesses and investors have to deal with. From recent experiences, we could see that investors and businesses needed to adapt to these new realities, including market access, right? Certain markets you could be shut out for political reasons, supply chain risks, disruption to that supply chain, you don't get your components, you are not able to do the production, as well as the changing demands of customers. Customers have very strong voice, especially for consumer products, employees as well. Your employees have certain view that you have to respect, to pay attention to, and other stakeholders, right? So all these are adding up to part of this change of the order, whether it's international or domestic. The third is the topic of today's conference, sustainability is a big thing. It can be thought of as externalities, right? The economists would like to think in that way. Externalities or impacts not yet captured by commercial prices. including the likes of social inequalities, climate change, data privacy, etc. There is rising demand of accountability for those externalities by stakeholders. You simply cannot ignore them anymore. They present both significant threats but opportunities as well. Using climate change as an example, we see the magnitude of its potential adverse economic impact. You looked at a research piece of Swiss Re Institute. They estimate that we could lose 18% of global GDP if temperatures rise by 2.3 degrees Celsius by 2050. 18% of global GDP. That's a lot. As an investor, we see three challenges in this path towards net zero. First, difficult trade-offs. Often, when we look at climate change sustainability issue, you have the inherent conflict of goals between, for example, security and green, between social goal and climate goal. You have conflict of time horizons. Do you need to achieve it in 3 years or do you need to achieve it in 30 years? The greening of energy is a good example. Its trade-off, its counterpart would be energy security, additional costs, and other ESG considerations, right? If you abandoned fossil fuel, you might deny access to jobs. You might even create gender or more gender inequality. So that's a difficult one. A useful angle here perhaps is to consider the additional cost involved and who is to pay for them. Of course, we always look to the government, public subsidies, taxpayers really, right? Carbon tax and other forms, grants, philanthropists, if only we have more philanthropists, consumers chipping in, paying a higher price for goods and services they use. Technology, that's the best. If technology can reduce cost curves, that's wonderful, right? Nobody has to really pay for it. And of course, scale economies. In some cases, the business model can address at least part of the cost addition by just building up the scale. So that's the first challenge, right? How do we deal with these trade-offs and the cost which come with it? The next is data. The quality of the data, the availability, the materiality, and the comparability for businesses and investors to make decisions. A good thing is that we are seeing progress. COP26 did bring about the international SSB, right, Sustainability Standard Board, that I think going forward, I think we have a better chance of finding available and consistent data. The third challenge is, of course, as investors in particular, to have investment vehicles which can help crowd in private capital. This is very much like all the discussions around public infrastructure, that for many years, the G20, for example, OECD, for example, have identified there's a huge need of public infrastructure, especially in developing countries. But we haven't been able to get a lot of private capital into that space, even though if you just do a kind of a research around availability of capital, there are trillions of capital available for investment into public infrastructure. But the problem lies with things like the project pipelines. How many of them are bankable? The problem lies with regulations. Does it come with too much political risks? The problem lies with scale, right? That especially for large institutional investors, you need scale for it to make sense. So to share an example, not quite in public infrastructure, but in the energy space, about 15 months ago, GIC invested about $2 billion US dollar in Duke Energy an utility company in Indiana, the state of Indiana in the US. That was only possible, and the money was meant for Duke Energy to green their power production because they had a lot of coal-fired power plants. And they needed some CAPEX money to get wind and solar energy. So we gave them $2 billion to do that. In return, we are able, as investor, to earn a slightly higher rate of return. That was permitted by the regulations in the state of Indiana. So that kind of regulatory design would help this process of crowding capital, private sector capital, into this effort of greening infrastructure. So that is, you know, a challenge because we are not seeing enough of those examples or availability. Now, importantly, beyond these challenges, we see opportunities. In fact, we see our investment universe as made up of three parts. The first is what we call new sustainable tech solutions. These are, of course, the renewables, right? The wind, solar, hydro. That's really good, right? The cost curve, in fact, have come down substantially in quite a lot of countries, so make it very commercially viable. Hydrogen, green hydrogen, still in R&D mode, I would say, in terms of scaling up, but promises. Nuclear fusion, carbon capture, usage, storage, perhaps we can look to tech to the rescue again, just like in the case of COVID vaccine. So that's the first category. In the investment universe, still relatively small. It might be billions, but in the context of the world investment universe, it's still a small sleeve. The second is the big one, right? What we call transition assets. These form the bulk, as really every asset, every business needs to transition. It's a matter of time. In fact, you should start now. And that's really the ultimate solution to climate change. It's a lot of work. It calls for a lot of what we would say bottom-up engagement, right? You have to work with a company to look at, you know, how can you green the assets? How do you repurpose some of the assets, right? The pipeline, you know, for natural gas could be changed to something else. So things like that, I think, offer quite a bit of promise. Here, we would also say we perhaps can use some so-called out-of-the-box thinking. For example, water scarcity, right, which is also a sustainability issue, a big challenge, in fact, because it can actually create conflicts between countries. We think we can use some out-of-the-box thinking. For example, consider reducing food waste, because you find that a lot of water goes into food, and actually if you can reduce food waste, you indirectly help address at least some part of the water scarcity problem. If you can increase energy efficiency, that also helps, right? Desalination, for example, which is difficult now because energy costs are high, but if we could somehow find a way to be more efficient, that will help. Economies of scale, I mentioned earlier, in a lot of municipal sort of water production, the scale is just subscale, right? The cost is very high. Perhaps there could be a reorganizing of the business model. So in trying to solve this sustainability challenge, you know, it actually offers a lot of innovation in terms of what we can do. And finally, of course, you're left with this, I would say, fairly small set of stranded assets, which come with all the dilemma, right? The thermal coal, you know, what do you do with it, right? In the short term, actually, in some countries, given what's happening, you might actually need to still use them, right? But really, longer term, they are not the solution and should be phased out. So that's the third big, you know, challenge, right? Sustainability. The fourth, and for the financial market people, it is all on our mind, which is inflation. Inflation directly erodes our purchasing power, right? The first job of any investor is really to do better than inflation. Otherwise, your wealth or your purchasing power just keep going down. You recall what I said about GIC's mandate is to preserve and enhance the international purchasing power. So it features right there, right? Already for many years. It's a reminder to all of us that you have to do better than inflation. Now, inflation is not just directly eroding your purchasing power there and then. It also has the effect of changing the interest rate regime. And that can usher in a whole new paradigm of economies and markets. Everybody now has dust off what in the 70s, right, happened in the US in terms of how they dealt with inflation, stagflation, and things like that. It's really important for us to understand how that episode developed and how we can draw lessons for the current period. Now, this is, of course, inflation is particularly troublesome if it is persistent, that's obvious, because it then has the potential to change the economic behavior, the psychology of people, consumer, businesses, workers, and that raises the dreaded risk of stagflation or hard landing, right? So that's a big one. This time round, right, compared to the 60s, you know, to the early 80s, really, there are significant risk of persistent inflation due to a number of factors. First, it is both a demand and supply factors, right? Sometimes we hear that it is supply chain disruption, no doubt. That contributes to inflation, but it's way more than that. The factors are broad-based. If you just look at the US, which is, of course, at the forefront of this, you see wages, you see commodities, you see housing, you see healthcare. Across the board, you're seeing inflation, you're seeing pressures building up. The longer-term backdrop, unfortunately, is also not very positive. You have what I call the five Ds. You have deglobalization, for various reasons, we are seeing that. Decarbonization, because of climate. Demographic change, right? You have shrinking of productive pool of workers. Debasement, just printing a lot of money. And what finally I call disillusionment, that if it is allowed to last, it changes expectation. You get disappointed and you take actions which result in more inflation. It is challenging to achieve soft landing. Historically, almost never succeeded, in fact. But clearly, the policymakers around the world are on very high alert, very high alert, and that's great. And there is, I would say thankfully, but very precious, still a window of opportunity in the form of anchored inflation expectations. Meaning inflation expectations are still okay for the medium term. The short term inflation expectations are pretty high. But that's not really the big thing. The big thing is, let's say, 3 years out, 5 years out, 10 years out. Are the inflation expectations still anchored, or have they run away? If you look at, since I used to trade bond, I look at this very closely. If you look at five-year inflation break-even forward, right? It's still at 2.5% in the US. Still, there's still a window to rein in inflation, to take control of that. So that's the fourth thing, inflation. And finally, of course, technology disruptions that we all feel it every day. It is bringing in an explosion of innovation across multiple fields. Now, for businesses, as well as investors, they often invalidate old assumptions and upend incumbents, right? Incumbents always have to be very careful about tech disruption. That because they show up in the form of new businesses, they show up in the form of disintermediation, right? If you are the middleman between, you know, a consumer and goods and services, that usually spells trouble in a world of tech disruption. And then in recent years, there's this emergence of big platforms where, you know, a lot of people spend their lives really just with one platform, right? So those are very powerful business outcome of tech disruption, something all of us have to pay attention to as well. So there you have it, my five-letter worder of the day. Posit, there is such a word, right? Means putting forward, right? P-O-S-I-T. There's a lot of balls to juggle, so I thought it might be useful to also just looking at these five, distill into three things. First is, of course, be clear about our purpose. Be clear about our purpose. That's most important. Even more important, we have to ask the question, what is our goal beyond profits? How are we using our strength to help others? All businesses need to ask this question. What useful societal functions are we serving? Who and what are we serving? In the words of Paul Polman, who is the former CEO of Unilever, he asked, is the world better off because we are in it? It better be, right? Purpose has always been important, and with the new societal expectation, it is fast becoming the key to our license to operate. Right? Without that, we might not even have the license to operate. Forget about thriving. So that's the first takeaway, right? The emphasis on purpose. The second is, of course, we need to adapt to the new environment. VUCA, right, which we are all very familiar with, it's a word that gets bandied around for 20 years. It has gone exponential. As if that's not enough, it's gone exponential. It's very demanding. I think today for any investor or business person to navigate this environment, we have to be armchair, the first epidemiologist, right? We have to go and study all the diseases and virus, vaccine and things like that. We have to become an international relations expert, right? Know the history of Europe and the Russian Empire. We have to become climate scientist. Impossible. We have to become macroeconomist, right? Study Volcker and, you know, Arthur Burns and people like that. And of course, to also at the same time, understand how technology is changing. Really challenging. But I would say in doing so, we have to, of course, keep ourselves up to date. It is actually really most important to get the basic principles right. For investors, that means be clear about our risk tolerance. How much risk do you really have? Of course, what is your investment objective? And in GIC's case, continue to emphasize diversification because that's the only free lunch in finance. Liquidity, it's quite important to keep liquidity. Don't run into problems that you cannot get out of. Patience, some of these things take some time to play out. And in the process, create opportunities and optionality. There are still ways we can do that. For businesses, it really still fundamentally is about being faster, cheaper, and better, right? We are not running away from that. But it also means being alert to these trends and being early in experimenting and learning. So that's the second takeaway. How do we adapt to the new environment? And finally, transition. Look at transition as a huge opportunity. It has all its attendant problems, but it also brings a lot of opportunities. Low carbon transition in particular. I mentioned the three subsets of investment universe. The biggest lies in transition. Getting to net zero requires a lot of money. McKinsey estimated at 9.2 trillion per year, right? Cumulative, you know, 275 trillion, right? Over 30 years. That's a lot of investment that one has to make, right? Investors and businesses are bound to find profitable ones. Investment in energy transition alone is already, you know, have to go from 2 to 4.5 trillion per year, according to IEA, by 2050. So the best investor and businesses have already moved. In fact, I would say the best university has already moved. I'll give you an example, NTU. NTU last year issued $650 million of sustainability-linked bond, the first by any university in the world, right? Taking a value creation view. Use the money, you know, for sustainability purpose. Going ahead, in fact, of others. Now, this is, of course, also a collective set of challenge. It's evolving, it's collective. So everybody has to work together. The problem is too big to go alone. We have to engage, we have to learn, we have to collaborate. So what Christina shared about the certificate program, the exact education, the case studies, all these are really important to push us ahead. GIC's own experience working with industry partners. We work with many industry partners from Climate Action 100 Plus, the Asian Utilities Engagement Program to help Asian utility companies to decarbonize because they are quite a big polluter. They are 23% of Asia's, you know, pollution of carbon. So we need to go to places where it's most difficult. CDP, TCFD, and lots of regulators. Those are our partners. We do joint research. We do one with Ortec, which is a risk consultant, on climate scenarios. Well, we did one with McKinsey on carbon markets, with Schroeder on avoided emissions, with Singapore Green Finance Industry Task Force on green taxonomies, right, getting the words right is very important. With World Economic Forum on ESG metrics. So lots of, you know, these collaborations are happening. And again, I think it's great that MBS is in a way bringing the industry in with the academia, and then we can come up with, I guess, the best way forward. So in conclusion, investing with purpose and responsibility is a continuous journey. But you know, it is undoubtedly, right, key to navigate this world in transition. We have to do it with purpose and responsibility. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lim. We would like to invite you to your seat on stage for the first panel discussion. Now, let us welcome the next panelist, Mr. Victor Lee, Chief Executive Officer of CIMB Singapore. Next, we would like to invite the moderator of this session onto the stage, Professor Lee Boon Keng, Director of Center of Excellence International Trading. Professor Lee, please. Before we begin, we would like to welcome all attendees who are joining us here in the auditorium to key in your questions in the attendee app at the Q&A tab. For the virtual attendees, you may also key in your questions in the chat box. Without further ado, I shall now hand over the session to Professor Lee.
Thank you, Brenna. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Chow Kiat, for a very enlightening opening keynote speech. I think there were many pointers that we can certainly take home with us, contemplate upon them, and figure out what we should be doing going forward. So today, I'm going to moderate this session in the following way. First and foremost, being the moderator, I'm going to just take some time for myself to ask this gentleman something that's always on my mind. So I'm going to just take those time first. And then what I'm going to do afterwards is essentially open the floor to questions from all of you, including those of you from home, watching this online, and I would then throw the questions to our panelists here. And of course, you can use the app to just send in your questions, and I will kind of ask them on your behalf. So first and foremost, I want to perhaps let Chow Kiat just take a breather for a while and ask Victor the first question. Now, Chow Kiat has talked about this world where we're in transition. A lot of things he had pointed out. From the investment perspective, right, things that we should go back and think about and even try to incorporate into some of our, the things that we'll do. I just like to ask Victor, what kind of role does a commercial bank, right, play in this entire transition?
No, thanks for the question, Prof. I think we are integral. We're really part of an entire ecosystem. And I think as far as CIMB is concerned, the journey started 4 years ago in 2018. And if I were to look at the timelines, I think pre-2020, sustainability was a topic, it was a checklist item, and it got very real in the last 2 years. And I think as we move forward, henceforth, it needs to be in and the DNA, and it cannot be anymore be a checkbox item. And really, the altruistic point is that it's really our earth. Mm-hmm. It is about our children's future, maybe not so much our future. So as a bank, you know, we have committed to 30 billion of sustainable finance. We have made statements, you know, by 2030, net zero within scope 1 and 2, and by 2050, complete net zero. And 2040, we say no more new coal thermal plants. So making very bold statements, transiting this, it's also very important to educate our customers, our shareholders, mm-hmm. And within the firm, it begins with our board of management directors and our staff. So actually, lots of things are happening.
Great. So I think it's very important. I think the word that you pointed out, which I think perhaps at some point in time, right, most of us will be thinking about is how do we build this into the entire financial DNA, right? Whether it's either in the form of investment or in the forms of financing, right? And of course, that really comes from, you know, how are we going to think of the entire process as part of how we live. Now, Chow Kiat, perhaps I'd like to take you on the journey that you kind of, you know, put us on, and that is on the issue of geopolitical and international order change. You mentioned that as one of your most, or one of the five factors that is impacting the world. Now, how do you think this geopolitical transformation that we're going on, from what you call a single pole to multipoles, how is that going to change how we treat this whole thing about sustainability? What are the trade-offs?
Right. As I mentioned, we have enjoyed, really, actually many years of, I would say, for most part of the world, peace and stability. So this is quite a change, right? And some people, in fact, characterize this as the biggest change since the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, before I was even born, right? So it's a huge seismic change. So one of the manifestations of this is globalization may not be at the same level anymore. Mm-hmm. So whether you are investors or businesses, you have to consider that. I think for businesses with supply chain all over the world, that is most obvious. For investors which have exposures all over the world, that's also, you know, very important, not as obvious, because you could also argue it means more need for diversification, right? But at the same time, you really have to be quite sensitive to ideas of some of those assets being caught up, you know, in some of these political moves. But the big thing really is have to rethink, right, the globalization sort of design and phase that we have gone through. We cannot take that for granted anymore.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Chokyo. What do you think, Victor? What kind of impact do you think this geopolitical transition that we're having, that we're in right now, how would that affect your view about this DNA that you were talking about? How do we build that DNA, incorporating this new transition?
Yeah, so I think for most of us in the for-profit organizations, I think there's a temptation that, you know, whether it's inflation going up, cost of goods going up, disruption, everything is just going up. There is just so much temptation to pull back and say, mm-hmm. you know, let's slow down investments in sustainability, and let's just protect ourselves, make our money. But I think then we really look from an organizational standpoint, our DNA and our culture. And within the bank, at a group level, you know, we have committed to 150 million of sustainability education to all our staff and to the general public. And we made those public statements, and we have to stick to those public statements because we know that future shareholders, investors, you know, private equities are looking at us. No organization cannot, must, every organization needs a sustainability agenda. Mm-hmm. You know, otherwise, you can actually see that being reflected in your share price, and it will crash. Not today, maybe, but for certain in the next 5 to 10 years. So that agenda is a real agenda as far as we are concerned. Mm-hmm. So internally within the organization, we are training everybody, whether it's through e-learning, mentorships. Everybody just needs to get into that culture of living, breathing sustainability in their lifeblood.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Victor. Okay, I want to talk trade-offs here. All right, it's kind of, I think, nice to say that, look, we understand the need to do it, right? We know the benefits of doing it. I want to talk trade-offs. What are the trade-offs are we talking about here? All right, are we going to have a come to a place where we think that, look, you know, the price that we pay, right, to get to the end point is actually worth, right, you know, the ultimate achievement. So maybe, Chow Kiat.
Right, yeah. So I mentioned a little bit in my remark earlier. I would say there are maybe three kinds of trade-off for businesses. The first is between profit and your other ESG goals,
yes.
Right? That's first. The second is among your stakeholders, right? They have different preferences. And the third is time horizon, right? So I would say on all three fronts, there have been movement towards more so-called stakeholder mindset, mm-hmm. That trade-off actually is, in a sense, becoming less going forward. Now, occasionally, you have things like energy prices, you know, causing energy security and things like that, that you have to pivot and address. But I find that more and more stakeholders are able to understand that the old way, for example, of simply and purely focusing on commercial profit is just not sustainable anymore. Because your customers are not going to stand for it. Your shareholders are not going to stand for it. So the societies have actually moved, right? So to that extent, the trade-offs are still difficult, but more manageable.
So there is buy-in. There is buy-in now. Victor, buy-in. Is there real buy-in? If from your angle, from your perspective, have we got the buy-in?
I think completely, really, and interestingly in ASEAN, maybe even more so than in the West, you know, I think in ASEAN we are really putting it into action. And, you know, in a lot of our sustainability-linked loans, you know, the incentives on reducing interest rates, provided you meet some sustainable KPIs, is really picking up quite exponentially. And it said, you know, in this part of the world, that could be a trillion-dollar opportunity for us. So for us, whilst we are for-profit, bringing the whole sustainability agenda in, you know, improves actually our business proposition from our standpoint.
Right. So the buy-ins, of course, ultimately has to end up with lining the pockets a little bit and not just pure expenses. Okay, I'm going to switch gear a little bit here because this is, of course, one of my most concerned issue right now, and Chow Kiat brought it up, and that's with respect to inflation, right? And Chow Kiat mentioned about inflation somewhat still being anchored today, right? And there are some evidence of it being anchored today, all right? But the way that I feel right now is that every time I go out there and I spend my money, I feel like I'm driven more and more to try to spend today, right, before the purchasing power gets eroded away. I used to pump, for example, only when I'm less than half tank, right? Today, I feel compelled to pump when I'm a quarter tank, done, right? Because I feel that if I wait for less than half tank, I may end up paying more. And of course, we call that inflationary expectations, right? Just building in that inflationary expectations into, right, how we live. And sustainability at the end of the day, right, boils down to how we choose to live, right? For this time and for our next generation, how we choose, how we make our decision, how we ultimately decide that, look, you know, that these are the prices I'm willing to pay. And inflation right now, yeah, I feel, is one of the prices that, you know, perhaps, you know, bring us maybe 6 months, maybe a year back, which seems a little bit more palatable as the price to pay to move into sustainability. Now, right, I'm feeling, wait a minute, if I do all these things, I'm adding that layer, right? Do you think that as a result of that layer now being added, right, we are going to be stalled somewhat in our journey?
Right. No doubt it makes it more difficult, right? Yeah. I mean, one way to think about this is that we have a budget, right? We have a budget that we can spend, whether it is financial resources or planetary resources, right? With the carbon, you know, capacity and things like that. At least, you know, for now, it looks like we have overspent. We have overspent, right? So the solution, the best solution, of course, is if you can increase your efficiency, productivity, you know, then you can continue to use the resources at the same rate. But more likely, you have to cut back. And that would represent some sort of sacrifice. But as I think Victor said earlier, at the same time, we need to invest because that's the way to increase the future budget. If we continue to invest, at least down the road, we have the prospects of regaining, you might say, our living standards, our ability, right, to have as much utilities. So I would say in the short term, of course, it requires some sacrifices, but really longer term, the key is if we continue to invest, we can actually still get a really good outcome.
Right, so technology to at least relieve those inflationary pressures. Victor.
Yeah, so I mean, it's, you know, with the oil prices going up, then obviously we're traveling less. So we are already doing our part, right? We are doing a lot more Zoom meetings. We're not traveling overseas. So whether it's COVID, whether it's this current energy crisis, we are all reflecting and re-baselining. You know, I think even within the firm, our OPEX have come down so substantially over the last 2 years. And we are now re-examining and say, hey, do we need to put that OPEX back? You know, are we going to save the OPEX that we have saved, operating expense that we have saved? Let's redirect it, you know, to sustainable finance right. for the future. Yeah, so I think on one part of the question really, the crisis creating inflation, you know, forces every one of us to relook. And we are constantly having to pivot and re-pivot, recalibrate, and re-strategize. Gone are those days where we have a five-year plan, a three-year plan. We seem to be having to recalibrate our plans intra-year, you know, especially in these last 2 years.
Great, thanks, Victor. Okay, I'm encouraging all of you to come in with your questions. So if you have the app, just enter your questions, then it should start to appear, right, as we move along. Okay, so maybe I'll just ask one last question, and then we'll move on to the audience to see if there are any questions that are coming in. And I should be able to see the questions as they come in. Just one last question, folks. Less developed countries, right? Are they ready for this? I mean, it seems that, you know, when we talk about sustainability, right, we always feel that, you know, the world ought to participate in all this thing because it's for the collective good, right? Does the more developed countries, right, have to pay the price for the less developed countries to come on board? Are the less developed countries ready for this? What do you think, Chuck?
Yeah, I can go first. That's a really difficult question. There is no question the developing countries or less developed countries are suffering two additional disadvantages compared to the developed ones. Number one, they are the manufacturing centers for a lot of the goods and products. And that is a major cause of carbon emission. So any attempt to reduce intensity of carbon emission, the burden falls on many of these countries. The second is that they have a lot less resources, right? I mean, I mentioned the ESG trade-off. The trade-offs are tremendous in a lot of these places. Mm-hmm. So that, I guess, remains a big difficult issue. Various COP, you know, conferences had always this agenda on it, but developed countries in particular have found it difficult, right, to do the transfer. That would be an important way, because ultimately, as you put it, we all live in the same village, that if the developing countries are not able to deal with that well, actually nobody is able to deal with this well. So I'm quite hopeful that, you know, there is more and more recognition of that. But we have limited budget, right, as a planet. So there have to be ways for us to get there. Now, to be sure, in some of the developing countries, let's say in Asia, you are seeing efforts, renewable, for example. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, using a GIC example, we invested in a renewable company in India about 8 years ago called Green Coal. It has about 7 gigawatt of capacity now, wind, solar, and hydro. It's quite big. It can power the whole Singapore, actually. And that's successful, right? Because the cost curve has come down so much that it's profitable. So if we can replicate that in more emerging market countries, and China is doing a lot of renewable, in fact, China can become a leader in that field and actually make a good living out of that. So it brings a lot of opportunities as well. Battery, right? That's another big sector. So there are various opportunities like that, even for the developing countries.
Yes. How do you Victor, how do you capture those opportunities? As a commercial bank, right, in those developing countries, how do you go and capture that? And in a way, right, be a partner and a habilitator, enabler for this?
Yeah, so I think fortunately, you know, there are two standards, right? The developed countries have a certain standard. You do understand that us in the developing countries, especially Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Thailand, you know, will have to take their pace. But what I'm seeing in countries like Indonesia, the large private enterprises, the government is taking that lead. And they know that, you know, if you want to export, you need to meet the new sustainability standards.
Sure.
And that's happening already. And in fact, you know, whether you look at palm oil, the waste of palm oil is far more valuable today than palm oil in itself, right? So the recognition is actually given, and, you know, hence in a for-profit orientation, then there is a lot of polarization towards, you know, green, ESG, sustainable products, waste management. All these are actually coming out quite nicely in the developing countries.
Right. Thanks, Victor. Glad to know that there's a lot of efforts driving this initiative. Now, I'm going to go to the audience. So I've got a few questions here. I think the first question on my list here is, you know, how would you advise firms to convince investors, all right, of the need to prioritize over ESG goals? Do you go out there and say, look, if you don't meet these goals, no money for you? Or do we say, let's do something so that they can transit?
Right. Actually, I mean, this is 2022. We already have lots of examples of companies which are on board or companies which are not on board having very different outcomes, whether it's their stock prices, their credit spread, or the treatment they get from customers and regulators. So I mean, we have not found a great need to convince companies to do that, and also for investors, right? Investors have seen actually, especially in the last few years, that it is possible to do good and do well at the same time, right? Simply because, again, everybody has recognized this as something important, something of value. The challenge is more the specific, the trade-off in the short term, right? So if you want to decarbonize your operations, what do you actually have to do? How do you explain to your shareholders? How do you explain to the market? So those things will require a lot of work. So as an example, we would send survey to our investee companies, or sometimes they send their survey to us. So my analysts and portfolio managers have to fill up all the forms to tell them exactly, right, our perception of their ESG practices and our suggestion to them, right? Maybe this is how you need to do it. And sometimes this is how you need to explain it. Especially for some Asian companies, they may not be so used to explaining to, let's say, Western investors. Mm-hmm. So we give them some ideas of how you can do that. So it is really now, I would say, in the weeds, you know, in the actual translation of their plans to actual steps, and how do you keep people informed. So I would say the big kind of hurdle in a way has been crossed. That you have to take this seriously. Now the challenge is more how to do it.
Right. Victor?
I think I basically resonate what Chokia was is really saying, and I think we're all on the same page. Yeah, I don't really have much to add.
Right. Yeah. Okay, I have a question here, and I think that's interesting. SMEs. Small, medium-sized enterprises. We talk about less developed countries, right? Obviously, if you look at the universe of companies out there, right, the SMEs are almost akin to, you know, your less developed countries needing the resources and all these things. Victor, SMEs, how do we approach them? How should we be engaging them?
So I think based on my personal experience, I think to tell an SME to get on sustainability is really going to be really difficult.
Right.
Because it's really day-to-day break-even that they're thinking about. They don't even have a proper finance or a HR department. And I still really feel that it needs to be led first by the government and the big corporations, right? And within the big corporations, within the supply chain, you know, once we set the standards, and even in our case, when we set the standards on our vendors, you know, that they have to meet the sustainability standards, there's a whole checklist of items before we decide to work with a vendor. The same thing can be done in the supply chain where the big boys have to impose. And naturally, the SMEs will take pace and pick up that pace to fall in line to that, to the whole global agenda.
Corporate leadership. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, SMEs are very important to economies, right?
Correct,
I mean, they usually will, you know, provide something like 60 to 70% of the jobs. So it's really important part of the economy. As Victor said, they need a lot of help. I happen to serve on the board of Enterprise Singapore. We are quite big on this. There are a lot of parallels with helping SMEs to go on the digital journey, mm-hmm. right? You know, that also was a big challenge and opportunity for a lot of SMEs. So for example, you need to get them onto some sort of platform, right? In the digital space, you have to get a lot of these SMEs actually onto, let's say, e-commerce platform. Because on their own, they may not be able to access their customers digitally, right? So there are ways to do that. It is important, I think, for SMEs to realize, and many of them have, that if they are supplying to, let's say, MNCs, the MNCs require their supply chain to have good sustainability standard. If not, you won't qualify,
right,
right, as a vendor. So I think that that recognition is, you know, step one, right? Step two is to try and find these channels, including sometime, you know, coming for classes, really, right? Just to learn more about it and then tailor to your own businesses.
Right. So everyone plays a role, I think, important role. And I think I have a question here that basically talks or asks, in this case, about how do we deal with regulations? Are regulations enough? Have we done enough in terms of ensuring that we are on that right path, right? And so the regulations are there, the investments and the support from corporate banks are there. Have we done enough? What do you think, Victor? Have we done it, or there's a lot more that we could do?
There's clearly a lot more we have to do.
Okay.
But I think this last one, two years, a lot actually has been done. To the extent that, to be honest, I think maybe more than 50% of our staff still do not completely understand sustainability,
right,
and why is that so important, which is why we are putting so much into actually training our staff first. So just as that dipstick, you know, I think we are moving at pace. Of course, more can be done, but you know, we need the budget and we need to progress in a logical way. Yeah, it's not really an overnight stuff.
Sure, Chowkiat, do you think regulators have done enough? Do a lot more.
Talking about regulators in general, they perform two roles, right? One is to prevent bad things from happening.
Right.
Right. But I think equally important, especially in sustainability type of matters, they also perform a supportive role. I think on the first one, you know, preventing bad things from happening, of course, I think it would be best if industry players do not wait for that, right? Because usually when bad things happen, the regulators will come in a big way, right, that nobody will be happy about. So it's really important for the industry to be proactive about it, right? Rather than wait for the regulators. Whereas the second, I think, as my example, about Duke Energy in Indiana show, actually the regulators can perform a very catalytic role, right? They can help bring in capital, in fact, if they are well informed about what, you know, various stakeholders need. So I see actually a lot of upside, you know, for regulators to do in that area as well.
Great, thanks. I'm reading some of these questions off the list here, so I don't get to all the questions because they're coming in quite fast. But you know, some of the questions are somewhat similar, so I'm kind of filtering them. So if I don't get to your questions exactly as you asked them, I apologize. But we will try to kind of consolidate as much as we can in terms of to ask our esteemed panelists here. So, okay, I got this one that I've always wanted to ask as well. All right, greenwashing, right? We go out there, right? We have these fantastic ideas here. Obviously, there are people who are out there greenwashing. How do you deal with that? From a financing point of view, Victor, and from an investment point of view, Chow Kiat.
Right. I think the first, I would say, has to start with ourselves.
Right.
That do not make claims which are not true, right? Making a net zero pledge, for example, long way out, could be one of those, unless you have an understanding of so-called science-based trajectory. How are you going to get there? In fact, I think the expectation down the road is that various stakeholders are going to demand to see the trajectory, to see whether it is science-based and whether it is realistic, right? So I think it has to start with ourselves. And then beyond that, actually increasingly because of disclosure requirements, because of, you know, many, many more activists and regulators coming onto the scene, I think greenwashing will be really difficult going forward. It's a risky thing, even if people wanted to do it. So I think it is much better, right, to do the hard work of explaining that, you know, we are not making this commitment because we don't have very high confidence of getting there. But let me share with you, right? These are what we are thinking about. But you might still not get there. I think you have to do the hard work of engaging with the stakeholders rather than sort of try and make that commitment and wish people will go away. They will not go away, right? In fact, it will bring a lot of reputation risk to the brand.
Yeah, I think people are very discerning. Analysts will be very discerning. Shareholders, very discerning. So, you know, greenwashing tantamount to telling a lie sometimes, right? Depending on how you look at it, will get caught out eventually. And as far as us as a bank is concerned, whether it's a sustainability-linked loan, we do our audits, right? Because there are sustainability KPIs we met to be eligible, you know, for a better interest rate, for instance. So we actually do those regular audits. And I mean, even within the organization, when we looked at work from home, does it tantamount to, you know, reducing carbon emissions because we're all working from home and we're not spending? And I actually called out to the EMA and say, but net-net, has electricity consumption gone down? The fact that it has not, right? So while as an organization, we can go and say, oh, we're working from home and we have saved, you know, reduce our carbon emissions. But the fact is that we are consuming and actually turning on so many air conditioners in the houses, and that's maybe, from a net perspective, not that great.
Right.
So I think we really need to have that DNA and that heart and that culture, you know, to want to drive for a better good.
Thanks, Victor. I think that's important, and I think that's what you guys have said is very important. It kind of starts from where we are first, right? It starts from us. And as investors and people who are lending money and creating that ecosystem, that we have to be the one that set the pace. I want to follow up a little bit on this. Do you think investors money managers like GIC, lenders like CIMB should go out there and participate in setting those standards to prevent those greenwashing, or should it be left to larger organizations as what we are right now? Should investors say, look, I want to, based on my own personal practices, have a say in how you determine whether or not a company, right, are meeting the standards for me to put out the money, for me to lend you the money, for me to invest in your future? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at it, even from purely an investment point of view, you have to, because these practices matter to your value, especially for a long-term investor, right? We're going to be there for 10, 15, 20 years. If the practices are not sustainable, most likely your investment value will be eroded, right? So we would want our investee companies to have good practices so that we get good return. Mm-hmm. So I think that is, you know, quite straightforward. I think the other aspect, maybe a bit more difficult, is do you go out of the way to advocate beyond your investee or your portfolio companies?
Right.
Right? We actually think that we have that responsibility as well. Mm-hmm. Right? Because we have the responsibility that the larger system is sustainable. Because we are going to be around for a long time. That if the system is not sustainable, we will also get the negative effect down the road. But we have limited resources. We can't chase every ideas. We can't chase every good ideas. So we limit ourselves to certain areas where we have sort of more resources or more expertise. Right? For example, I listed some efforts we partners with. I think those we feel we have responsibility and we have the expertise. But beyond that, I think, you know, it might be difficult for us to expend more resources.
Right.
Yeah, I think from my perspective, you know, we have a vision goal, 2030, you know, net zero, scope one, scope two. And given that we have a choice, we choose not to bank with those, you know, whom we feel at the management bench strength aren't really signed up to that. Or, you know, there are proven cases of greenwashing, then we can choose, and we will choose not to work with them.
Right. Okay. I hope the questions can keep coming in. I like to take this opportunity to also seek your thoughts, just maybe changing gear a little bit, on perhaps, you know, how your outlook of where the global financial market is going in the next couple of years, and how that fit into how you would advise, you know, investors as well as businesses, right? So it's more your personal analysis of where things are going and how you're going to, you know, advise people what to do, right? I know Chow Kiat have spoken a lot about that, you know, but your personal thought, I mean, if I were to put you in the corner in your quiet moments right now, what would you say? What would you think?
I would say the same thing, that it's important, I think, for the next maybe couple of years to pay attention actually to all the five things that I mentioned, but in particular, inflation. Mm-hmm. I think that's a paradigm-defining type of driver. That, you know, if it changes the whole monetary policy regime, it changes the shape of financial markets. So that, I mean, if you were to spend time, you know, that would be one thing that I would spend a lot of time on.
Right, Victor?
I think from the banking perspective, I think every bank really is and already or have started, you know, building up their sustainability committees. So at the board of management level, at the director level, that's all some infancy, but that's building up. And it's heartening to note that with that, I think it can become operational. It can be sustainable in every bank. Right.
Okay, so perhaps I just, take this opportunity right now. I think we have got good questions here, kind of most of the questions. And perhaps take this opportunity to thank our panelists for sharing their thoughts and their views, very candidly, I think. So we'll end the panel session here and hope that all of you have benefited from this session. I think it was very well said by both of you. So again, thank you very much, gentlemen. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Prof.
Thanks.
Thank you for the insightful session. May we invite all the panelists on stage to return to your seats. Today, it is our honor to witness the casebook launch by Asian Business Case Center, Nanyang Technological University.
Company to reduce our plastic waste meat from the clean solutions.
It can bring impact to people's lives. And that's through ethical consumerism and that's through ethical purchases.
We must make this effort. Otherwise, one day our children and grandchildren will be ashamed of what our generation did not do.
We would like to invite Professor Foo Maw, Director of Asian Business Case Center, on stage to give a speech. Professor Foo, please.
Good afternoon, Professor Christina Soh, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is with much delight that I introduce the casebook Towards a Sustainable Future, Delivering Positive Economic, Environmental, and Social Impact. Sustainability is a key issue that organizations and institutions around the world grapple with. This multimedia book comprises numerous cases that explore various perspectives of sustainability, as well as organizations and institutions at the forefront of this field. Although most of the cases are set in Singapore, the principles of sustainable development are applicable far beyond this little red dot. The challenges of social enterprises' dual mission of doing good while staying financially viable, of established companies' efforts to groom and retain human capital, and government's coordinated efforts to build a livable and sustainable future are universal and applicable to many organizations and countries. We aim to spark discussion on how doing good and doing well can be and are complementary, and to highlight the triple bottom line of economic viability, social impact, and environmental sustainability as a primary metric to steer organizations and institutions towards thoughtful action and to co-create sustainable living for the future. This book is published using FSC-certified paper, and complimentary e-copies can also be downloaded from the Asian Business Case Center's website. It is with great honor that I invite Professor Christina Soh to officially launch the book. Professor Soh, please.
Thank you, Professor Soh. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now adjourn for coffee break. To our virtual attendees, you may join us online again on our virtual event platform at about 3:30 p.m. for our next panel discussion. See you later. We would like to welcome back all on-site attendees and virtual attendees. We will now be commencing our next panel discussion on how should companies address the sustainability challenges. Now, we would like to welcome the panelists. The first panelist is Mr. Eric Lim, Chief Sustainability Officer of UOB. The next panelist will be Ms. Lynette Leong, Chief Sustainability Officer of CapitaLand. The last panelist is Mr. Constant Van Arschot, Director of WBCSD Asia Pacific. Next, let us welcome the moderator for this session, Professor S. Vishwanathan, Director of Center for Business Sustainability. Before we begin, we would like to welcome all attendees who are joining us here in the auditorium to key in your questions in the attendee app at the Q&A tab. We will also welcome questions from the floor during the Q&A session. For the virtual attendees, you may also key in your questions in the chat box. Without further ado, I shall now hand over the session to the moderator. Professor S. Vishwanathan, please.
Thank you, and welcome back, everyone. I hope all of you had a good coffee break and managed to network with some of the participants. So in the previous session, the keynote speaker introduced the POSIT framework, the pandemic, the political order, sustainability, inflation, and technologies. I'd like to believe that among all these, some of them are short-term challenges. Probably the longest-term challenge for companies as well as society is probably sustainability. And during the discussion, it was already mentioned that the trade-off is probably switching towards stakeholders rather than profits now. Of course, climate change is the biggest part of the sustainability challenge. And I think, again, one of the panelists mentioned that even investors and consumers also care about sustainability now. So, and the nets, it's not just the companies that are making net zero promises. Private equity firms are also doing that. And in Singapore itself now, we have the ESG, the SGX ESG reporting requirements that has been mandatory for companies of a certain size. For the past 3 years, you have to either comply or explain. And post the last election in 2020, we have become very aggressive in our carbon tax policies. Earlier, the announced policy was that we'll keep it at $5. It was when we started it. And we'll get to $10 or $15 by 2030. Now, of course, it's going to be $25 by 2024, $45 by 2026, and $50 to $80 by 2030, right? So which means our carbon tax regime is probably as tough as some of the European countries in a sense. So again, there was some discussion about SMEs. How can SMEs afford to do it? The reality, again, as mentioned, most of the SMEs actually have large, are probably in the B2B business, and their customers are large multinational corporations. And so when the multinational corporations are challenged by stakeholders and they have sustainability goals, they will naturally ask their suppliers about their sustainability efforts. So even the SMEs have no choice but to actually embrace sustainability in a big way. So many of the corporate partners who are in attendance today are probably a mix of SMEs and large companies. And also there is a bit of heterogeneity among them in terms of their sustainability journeys. So what we are going to do in this session is probably at least the first part when I'm discussing with the panel, it'll be more of a conversation about what I call sustainability 101. How can companies kickstart their sustainability journeys, right? So we're going to spend about the first 30 minutes doing that. And then we'll open the floor for questions as such, right? So we have three fantastic panelists here, and I'm going to briefly introduce each one of them. So the lady first sitting in the middle, Ms. Lynette Leong. She is Chief Sustainability Officer of Capital Land Group. She has been holding that position for the past 3 years. She also serves on the boards of National Environment Agency, NEA, the Singapore Green Building Council, and she's also on the advisory board of SMU's Lee Kong Chiang School of Business. She has international experience in banking and finance and real estate fund management in the US, United Kingdom, as well as Asia. And she has been in senior management leadership positions, in the senior management leadership team at Capital Land Group for over 12 years. Prior positions she has held include being the Chief Business Innovation Officer at Capital Land Group, as well as CEO of Capital Land Commercial. Welcome, Lynette. Right. Our next panelist is Eric Lim. Eric is actually, and this is what I found on your website, is UOB Group's, United Overseas Bank Group's first Chief Sustainability Officer. And he was appointed to that position in April 2021. Both Eric and Lynette have been in senior management positions for a long time, but they're relatively new to a formal position in, as a Chief Sustainability Officer. So Eric, as a Chief Sustainability Officer at UOB Group, leads a dedicated corporate sustainability office. Concurrently, he's also the head of the group finance, responsible for all the bank's core finance functions. Prior to UOB, Eric was managing director and head of wholesale banking at Standard Chartered. Eric has an MBA, EMBA from Kellogg School of Management. But most importantly, Eric is a proud alumnus of our NTU accountancy program. So welcome back home, Eric, all right? Last but not least, we have Constant Van Urschot. He is the Asia-Pacific Director of WBCSD, World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And if I understand correctly, he has been in that position in Singapore for the past 9 years. WBCSD is the premier global CEO-led community of over 200 companies. And some of the Singaporean companies like Olam are members of it. In fact, the CEO of Olam is the current chairman of WBCSD. It's a community of over 200 world-leading businesses working collectively to accelerate the system transformations needed for a net zero, nature positive, and more equitable and sustainable future. He's a sustainability and construction sector expert, and he supports member companies, that is the WBCSD member companies in Asia, to learn, share, and adopt the latest sustainability tools, standards, and methodologies in their business strategy. He started his career as a design engineer in the civil engineering and construction sector. And before WBCSD, he was a vice president of foresight at cement manufacturer Lafarge. And before that, he was a corporate strategist at Alcatel. Welcome, Constant. So as I said, I'm going to start the discussion asking about what should companies do at the beginning in terms of sustainability. So the first question, actually, I'm going to pose to all the panelists are essentially the same. So to start with Lynette, what are the first steps companies, what are some of the first steps that companies should take to make their operations more sustainable and socially responsible?
Thank you, Vish. First of all, I just want to thank Vish and NTU for inviting me to be on this panel. I really love the auditorium and the premises. I wish I studied here. So the first thing, I just want to borrow what Chow Kiat said earlier, posit, and the P, it was the first letter, and P means purpose. So I think for any company, you need to understand what your purpose is. It is, yes, you may be making, profitability is very important, and just as us, we are a public listed company. So clearly, profitability is very important to us. But at the same time, it is also as we grow our business, we have to understand the stakeholders whom we impact. And our stakeholders are namely our, besides our investors, our customers, our employees, and our supply chain. So as we grow our business profitably, what we look towards is generating long-term economic value, at the same time contribute to the environmental and social well-being of the communities in which we operate. So that, is, in effect, is our purpose statement. And to do that, I think you have to have, it starts from the very top, the board of directors have to endorse that you have that purpose in mind. Your company may be in different businesses, but you need to identify what your real purpose is. So your board of directors, once they endorse that, then it has to percolate throughout the organization. And I think earlier, Victor also mentioned about the different, how they actually implement that throughout the organization. For us, we have different kinds of committees. Every single level of the hierarchy, we have different committees, sustainability committee. Horizontally, now we are in more than 250 countries, 250 cities, and over 30 countries. So it is not easy to embed sustainability throughout the entire organization. So we do that with committees, laterally as well as vertically. In each country, in each business unit, we also have sustainability committees. And then the next thing is that we have to understand what our goals are. So what we did was to set a 10-year master plan for that. 10 years is because sustainability is a journey. So if you're only starting out, don't worry, because a lot of people are also starting out. We started 20 years ago, it has taken us a long time before we got to where we are today. So there is a need to start and set targets for yourselves. So in our case, we set a strategy for the next 10 years, aspirational targets. Today, we can't imagine how we're going to achieve it, but you need to set that kind of goal. And then while it is a 10-year master plan, we recalibrate our targets every 2 years so that we take into account what the standards are in the market, as well as what technologies are taking place so that we can then reassess whether our goals are too easy or we should be more aspirational. So that's our master plan. And at the same time, then how do we get there? We have to look at the pathway. So we have actually five pathways. First is to make sure that in every stage of our real estate life cycle, from investment to how we construct buildings, how we design, and all the way to how we operate our buildings, sustainability is taken care of in our policies, in our best practices. Then the second one is we have to embed innovation and technology. And to that end, we have an annual Sustainability X Challenge where we source globally for solutions for our building operations. The third one is data analytics. Yeah, because our market trends, we need to understand how they impact us and how we impact them. The fourth, which is important, it is our performance is monitored very closely. And we also disclose our performance in our annual sustainability report. And it is also audited. There was talk about greenwashing earlier on. So we make sure we audit our performance, and therefore, no one should be able to fault it because we have evidence to prove that we are actually performing. And the last but not least is stakeholder engagement. Yeah, we were just talking earlier about our board level. How do we... Not all board members have the same level of knowledge. So we have to constantly make them aware and also throughout the entire organization to communicate to them, and as well as our external stakeholders like your customers, your supply chain, as well as your investors. You know, they have to understand how your company is positioned to manage some of the climate change risks, for example. And at the same time, this is not about being altruistic. It's not just fulfilling something because it's, we just want to set certain very washy targets. But then this is real. Climate change is real and it will affect our business. But we want to turn risks into opportunities as well. So we are also at the same time looking at how we can value add to the organization.
Thank you, Lynette. So if I were to summarize Lynette's response in a few bullets, of course, the most important is top management support. Even the board of directors need to be educated on sustainability. Otherwise, what can happen is just like Exxon, maybe the activist investors can change the board of directors. They have the power to do that as well. Then the next one is, of course, aspirational targets. So, of course, there's a thin line of difference between aspirational targets and greenwashing. Sometimes aspirational targets are important and you need to announce to the world so that then you make the commitment to actually go to net zero, for example.
So our carbon targets are science-based. Okay. It's validated by the Science-Based Targets Initiative.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Then, of course, the most important is using technology to enhance your the pathway to the aspirational targets. And finally, monitoring of performance. So that's the four bullets I could take away from.
And stakeholder engagement.
And stakeholder engagement aspect, right. So thank you, Lynette. So I'm going to essentially ask the same question to Eric as well, because Eric comes from a different industry in a sense, so the perspective can be very different. So again, what are the first steps that companies should take to make their operations more sustainable and socially responsible?
Yeah, thanks, Vish. And I think, Lynette, you can tell how experienced a CSO she is, because in that 5 minutes, she gave the master class, right, in sustainability and business. So let me add on to that, right, and build upon that. To say, Lynette started with purpose, and I think that's very important, right? And the reason it's important is if you find the right purpose statement and articulation for your business model, you know how to guide your sustainability strategy and roadmap from there. Case in point, for us, our purpose statement is to forge a sustainable future together with our clients. So it's very clear for us as a financial services provider and player that we are an enabler of the economic success both in society and community, but we effect this through our clients. We can't do it all by ourselves, right? And so we're very focused on understanding what our client needs would be, what the threats, what the opportunities are, as the world shifts towards a sustainable future. Okay, we did a recent SME Outlook survey, and one of the questions we asked was, how critical do you think it is to build sustainability into your business operations going forward? And the good news and the bad news is 3 out of 5, called 60% of our SMEs said it is critical to build sustainability into their business operations going forward. Now, it's great news because 60% of SMEs get it. It's horrible news because 40% of SMEs don't get it. And you almost have to step back and go, in 2022, when the whole world is screaming sustainability, why is 40% of the SME base still not clued in on, number one, what sustainability really means, why it matters, and how to go about it, right? And so one of the first pieces is really getting that business case embedded into the minds of every board member, every senior manager, such that it can percolate down to the entire organization. Now, the easiest way to do this, and you know, like Vish mentioned, I'm a finance guy, I'm also a sustainability guy, so it's very easy for me to flip between two sides of the house. So let me use financial language, right, which I know really appeals to business owners, right? Think of your P&L first and foremost, right? Think about how sustainability relates to your customers, the products and services that generate that revenue, as well as market share. And in a world that's moving more and more sustainable, if your customers demand sustainable products and services that you can offer credibly, you will gain in market share. The flip side of that is if you're unable to be competitive from a sustainability standpoint, you will lose market share and you will lose revenue strength, right? So that's the first way to translate sustainability into commerciality almost, right? The second way is then to think about your supply chain, right? Everybody buys something from someone, everybody sells something to someone. Understanding your supply chain, who you procure from, who your vendors are, and what their sustainability practices are, will allow you a very quick and easy way to understand how resilient and sustainable your own supply chain is, right? The third is to then understand your own operations, because in all of our operations, using terminology of scope 1 and scope 2, you will create your own footprint, right? And like Vish mentioned, with the onset of carbon taxes increasing over the next decade or so, there is a real commercial cost to sustainable versus non-sustainable operations that will start to differentiate your ability to have cost leadership and your ability to therefore price competitively. And the last thing I would share with all of our business owners out there and management is the concept of human talent, right? We talked a bit about upskilling our talent, but there is also a real opportunity to attract young talent who understand sustainability and want to participate in building a better world, an ability to really retain them versus a competitor who wants to just come and throw another 15% salary on the table, and that it links back to that purpose, right? Large company, medium company, small size company, if you can find that clarity of purpose and infuse it through your business model, your business operations, and your people, that's how, Vish, to your question, an organization can really get ready and move on this journey.
Thank you, Eric. So if I were to try to summarize what Eric said, the first thing is you need to start with the purpose and then understand your business model. And from that, you derive your overall strategy. And sustainability has to be incorporated into the business strategy itself, right? It's a, in a sense, it's a business imperative. And then taking the lens of a bank or a financial services company, the first thing is sustainability can help you gain market share, right? By offering the right mix of products that are more sustainable. And then in terms of improving further within the organization, for any organization, you look at the supply chain first. What are the supply chain partners doing in terms of sustainability? And make sure that you actually go with partners who are more sustainable. And then the third thing is to look at the internal operations itself and look long term. And even though the carbon tax is probably going to become 50 or 80 now, maybe prepare for it now itself and take aggressive action, assuming that you're already paying that. I mean, that's something called internal carbon tax that many companies adopt. And finally, of course, human talent, the younger people would like, are much more sustainability oriented than we are. And therefore, it's a proactive strategy to actually attract talent into the company as such, right? So thank you, Eric. I think I also mentally wanted to plug some of our programs here because you mentioned about the SMEs, and you can look at it as glass half full or glass half empty. 40% of the SMEs don't get it. And then, of course, within the company itself, there was a lot of discussion, even in the previous session, about Victor mentioning that a lot of people have to be trained. And our dean, Professor Soh, mentioned at the welcome that we are launching a couple of programs. And I think I should add that those programs are eligible for Skills Futures benefit as well. So let me just do that plug-in just now. Now I come to Constant. Again, I'm going to ask exactly the same question. What are some of the first steps that companies should take to make their operations more sustainable and socially responsible from your perch as a person advocating sustainability to all your member companies?
Sure, thank you. First, it's very difficult to speak after being the last speaker because most of it has been said already. So I will just try to add on. But the first step is really to look at the materiality. That's step number one. What is my business about? What do I need to measure and why? If you are a service company, you don't need necessarily to measure your water consumption. If you are in the beverage sector, that's a must. So look at what is material to your business. Number two, I would say, is internal or external. So the internal side is understanding and measuring the performance of your business that is non-financial. Mm-hmm. Those KPIs and so forth, define them. Then, of course, read, learn, come to NTU for training or other places to understand what sustainability is, because there is a big need, big appetite for this. And it's normal because it's relatively a new topic for many in the region. So, and then I would say another part is, which is the more external part, is look at what your customers need. It was mentioned that your big corporations have their target. How do they meet the target? Do you have a solution for those companies to enable them to reach those targets? I'll give you an example of Olam. Olam was mentioned earlier. And Nestle. Nestle, big client of Olam. Nestle, a few years ago, realized 50% of what we purchase as raw material, we don't know where it's coming from. Big risk. Child labor, deforestation, you name it. So Olam, who is a supplier of coffee and many other commodities to Nestle, said, well, actually, I know where it's coming from. And so they say, well, we can provide you with information at farm level or at country level, so depending on the granularity of information you want. So you see those big players have those big challenges. But now as an SME, if you're an innovative SME, you can say, well, actually, I know how to deal with data. I have a solution that actually helps both Olam and Nestle to actually provide the information in a transparent way, consistent way, so that both can fulfill their promises. So for the SMEs is knowing your footprint, your business, look at what innovation and what solution actually can help the big companies achieve their own goal.
Okay. Yeah, I think you already summarized it, but it's understanding what is material for the company. If it's a beverage company, obviously water consumption is most important. For other companies, something else might be more material. So first thing is to do you don't have to do a very complicated materiality analysis. It can be something that can be sort of brainstormed and done internally if you're a small organization. Then look at both internal and non-financial performance standard and see how you can measure and further improve it. And then look external. And earlier Eric mentioned about market share. So what the example that Constant provided might be a way to actually garner more market share by not just by selling a product, but also providing information related to sustainability about the product, the sourcing aspect, the environmental footprint aspect as well. And that could create a competitive advantage. Thank you, Constant. So now I'm going to the second set of questions. And I start with Lynette again. So one area that, Singapore being sort of a city-state. For many companies, it's buildings, and you come from the building sector. So one area, in fact, all companies can look at, whether you're a company in the hard-to-abate sector, or whether you're a IT company, or whether you're a hospitality or service operations company, all companies have to deal with their offices and buildings as such. So so that's something common across all companies. How can they make their buildings more efficient and sustainable? So the question to Lynette is, what can companies do to make their buildings more efficient and sustainable?
I wanted to go back to what Constance said about materiality. Mm-hmm. We are, because of carbon taxes and because of inflation, you find that energy prices, electricity prices have actually gone up. The carbon prices, we may not be affected that directly, but it's actually indirectly passed through the GenCos to us in the form of electricity tariff rates. Of course, it's also due to inflation. So we are all affected by sustainability, whether it's material or not. You know, so if you are an SME, you have your cars, your trucks, right? Yeah, your petrol prices have also gone up. If you're in a building, if you own the building, of course, you know, your electricity, the cost of dry powering, your lights, your air conditioning is also gone up. So it does pay to reduce the energy consumption or to make it more energy efficient. Very practical ways, let's increase the temperature of our air conditioning, right? In many places, you see people still wearing like scarf and sweaters and all. It's not necessary. And then you go out, you're so hot. Yeah. So actually, if you just increase your temperature by 1 degree, you can save your energy consumption by at least 2%. You know, depending on your the equipment, right? So if it is a brand new equipment, you can't do much to you. It's already energy efficient, but you just have to operate that. Use LED lights, for example. Have sensors in your toilets. Most of the time, nobody uses the toilet, right? So the lights are off. Only when you go in, motion sensors, then the lights switch on. So there are simple things that you can do in the office. Now, besides just energy directly, water consumption is also a form of a resource that contributes to climate change. Waste is the same thing. So in the building industry, in the real estate industry, we look at just very simply, ESG is a common term which many people now use, many companies now use. Environmental, social, and governance factors. These are very, very easy to understand. And so environment, what are the environmental factors? Energy, water, waste. Now, and then social would be the people, your customers, your employees and your investors, right? And then governance is quite clear. So let's take environmental. We are all affected by environmental factors. So if you save energy and you save water, now, if you were to save water, it also means that the water consumption drops. Your energy indirectly, energy consumption will also indirectly also fall, because if you are using less water to the, for example, you use less water in your air conditioning, or the cooling tower uses less water, the amount of energy to power the energy, the cooling tower can also drop if the efficiency rises. Going to a bit too technical, I think. But waste, if you manage your waste well, if you do not consume so much or you recycle, then all the waste does not go into landfill. It does not. Then you do not need to. The government does not need additional sanitation to go and clear the rubbish. It actually saves cost. It saves energy in some way. So it's a very circular thing. You know, so I think it's whenever we operate the business, there are so many areas that you can think about reducing, and therefore it will help to reduce your cost and contribute better to your bottom line. So I think that's where I would come from when we look at how to do it. So from the building's perspective, we are a landlord, right? We have tenants. So we encourage our tenants to save electricity or save energy or save water by something called a green lease. So in addition to them signing a commercial lease, they sign an additional lease called a green lease, which specifies some of the areas that we think they can save, like energy and water. So we also share with them how they can possibly save that through motion sensors, as I mentioned, LED lighting, and so forth. So some of these practices are your daily practices. Some of them are your business areas that you can possibly look through, and all these actually add up, especially when energy prices are going up and cost of waste management fees are also rising. So that actually helps you to contribute to your bottom line in a positive way too.
Okay, thank you, Lynette. So quite a few technical matters mentioned, but some of them are actually low-hanging fruits. Increasing temperature, and I'd like to believe that the temperature in this room has been set probably to the optimal, even though it's a large room with less number of people because of distancing. It doesn't feel too cold, right? So that's the change that NTU has made. Having LED LED lights to the extent possible, sensors so that the bulbs switch off automatically. Then, of course, linking water consumption to energy consumption, because the more water you consume, there is pumping required for the water, so that the energy consumption can go up. And again, the most important thing, even if you're a consumer who's only having scope 2 emissions, that is emissions from electricity usage that is less than 25,000 tons per year, you are effectively still paying carbon tax because the increase in cost is being passed to you. Right? And of course, then managing waste as well. So this leads me directly to go to Eric, because some of these, even these low-hanging technologies, maybe a company with deep pockets where they have a longer-term horizon. For example, we know that if you're replacing all the bulbs with LED, the cost of the LED bulb is much, much higher than a regular bulb, ditto with installing rooftop solar panel and so on. So even though they are NPV positive in the long run, net present value positive in the long run, the challenge is that there is a huge upfront investment required, and the time by which you will actually turn black in terms of the investment is much longer. So if you're a company who doesn't have that long deep pockets, how can green financing help companies in their sustainability journey, and how does a bank like UOB help their clients in their sustainability journey?
Vish, thanks. So financing, obviously, very important, because from a cash flow perspective, this is where a financial services provider like UOB steps in to make the commercial case work, even if the cash flows need to be lumpy, right? And so the first thing I would say is, When an organization starts to go on the sustainability journey, back to materiality first, understanding where the biggest impacts are is important, because that's kind of where you want to know where you want to make your investments. The last thing you want to do, especially if you're SME, is spread yourself too thin, right? And almost die in the cross of sustainability. Remember, you have to make it work. Making it work is important, right? And so when we embarked on building our sustainability financing products, right, we tried to make it as practical as possible to understand where the greatest needs would be across the corporate space. And so we came up with 4 sustainable financing frameworks, right? One, to do green real estate, very established asset class. Lynette knows this, you know, back, front, left, center, right? The second one was around smart cities, which is around renewable energy, electrification of the transportation grid, water and waste management. Now you can start to see that reinforcing theme of what Lynette's talking about versus what the financiers are willing to finance, right? The third one is around the circular economy, right? Making sure that your operations take as little as possible and make those inputs and raw materials as circular as possible. Again, reduction of waste, right? And then finally, green or sustainable trade finance. So it was amazing for me to listen to Lynette, because everything she's talking about in the real world were mirroring in the financing world, right? And so you can already start to see that resonance, okay? The next thing I will say is making it accessible is even more important. So what we did in UOB is we came up with these, what we will call ecosystem plays, right? We've got three of them. U-Solar is to help the implementation, development, and adoption of renewable energy or solar energy. And in these ecosystem plays, we bring the ecosystem partners, you know, installers, monitors, with N-Corps, as well as individual customers. You package it with the bank's balance sheet and financing, and you offer it as an easy-to-adopt solution. So that's how we think about going the extra step to help especially SME customers in adopting renewable or sustainable solutions, right? And we've got two more, one called U-Energy, which is all about energy efficiency. You talk about the LEDs, you know, Lynette talked about the chillers and the coolers, right? This is that stuff, right? We can help finance. Take out that big slug of cash flow in the upfront and be able to spread that cash flow throughout the loan of the term of the loan. The third one is called U-Drive, which is all about EV charging infrastructure as well as the adoption of EV fleets, right? Now, for any of the customers that find themselves falling into these sustainable finance frameworks or these what we call ecosystem plays, financing becomes really easy. Step up to your UOB banker and say, I want green or sustainable financing, right? Now, if none of these fit nicely, there is still one more financing format that all banks, including UOB, are more than happy to support in. And it's called sustainability linked loans or sustainability linked financing. And what this category of financing recognizes is not everybody is going to be doing solar panels or EVs or energy efficiency, but an organization still wants to go on a strong and ambitious sustainability journey. And in that kind of sustainability linked financing, we help the company develop what we call SPTs or sustainability performance targets. And these performance targets can relate to E, S, or G, can reference the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals, can reference a climate action goal. And in that way, the bank is also able to help our customers go on that journey. Now, all of that sounds quite a lot, but it's okay. You've got friendly bankers you speak to. They'll explain it all to you. The good news is every bank wants to be able to do green and sustainable financing. So if you've got the will, trust me, we've got the money. Yeah. Back to you, Vish.
Thank you, Eric. So if I were to use terminology used in the supply chain and technology software company world, essentially your ecosystem plays like a end-to-end solution, right? So if a company wants, you're not just a banker just giving out loans. You actually provide the entire services along with a team of experts in whether it's EV or whether it's energy. You actually bring in the consultants and the domain expertise out there and help the help the customers as such. So it's not just about the financing itself. And so you mentioned about circular economy. So I'm going to have one last discussion with Constant before I turn over to the audience for questions. Constant is also an expert in circular economy and WBCSD issues standards in circular economy as well. And that's a hot buzzword that you've been hearing all the time now. So again, circular economy is a very complex subject. We know that we have a research center in NTU as well looking at recycling of e-waste and so on in a very non-intensive way as such. What are some of the first steps that a company can do towards implementing circularity in their operations and supply chain?
Thank you. I think we really have to distinguish operational efficiency from what we call circular economy. An economy is much bigger. Mm-hmm. A operational efficiency. When I was working at Lafarge, we reused everything in gypsum that did not meet the quality standard. We reused everything. Mm-hmm. So operational efficiency is a given because it's more, you know, it just makes business sense to recycle and reuse whatever does not meet a certain quality standard, etc. So this is not what what we're talking about. Circular economy, we did a survey 5-6 years ago and asked companies, how do you measure your performance on circular economy? And 75% said, well, we have our own consultant, we have our own standard. So of course you cannot compare, you cannot track progress, etc. So 24 companies led by KPMG under the WBCSD, we said, okay, we have to create a standard to define what are the indicators of circular performance. And we asked, you know, companies, okay, which indicators, what do you measure? And 100% said we measure material flow. Then second position was energy and third was water. So we said, well, we have to develop a standard that is transparent, not that every consultant can use instead of using their own methodology. It's a bit like accounting. You have to use the same standard so that you can compare. So in 2 years, we developed this standard on metrics, how to measure a performance on circular economy. And it's about defining the words. I think this the panel earlier defined the words count. So if you have the same definition, at least you can measure the same thing. So it's about minimizing the use of non-renewable virgin material. So depending on where you are in the supply chain, whether you are a raw material producer, sand that goes into concrete, for example, then you, as a property developer, you will need the information, how much of the sand comes from virgin resources. Maybe you have some recycled content in it, but at least you will need the information from your supplier. At the same time, you will need to send the information of how much recycled content you put in your concrete to give it to your client, to those who buy your buildings. So those metrics are being defined in terms of percentage of non-renewable or non-renewable virgin sources, and how much goes into the landfill and being incinerated. So there is, it's a value chain effort. So everyone needs to understand how much recycled or recyclable content is a product that is you're doing buildings, but it's applicable to iPhones and others, goes into your product and service. So those metrics are defined in this standard.
So if I may, in the real estate industry, we have a term called embodied carbon, which means that every single material we use has a certain element of carbon emissions computed based on the entire supply chain, from how it is manufactured to how it's transported, all the way to how we procure it. So they add up all the amount of carbon emissions, and it's then put into a certain figure for called an embodied carbon. So for example, concrete has got an embodied carbon of some say it's 200. Aluminium, right, has a embodied carbon of 300. When you're constructing a building, we have to make the right choices. What is it that we should be using? Does the aluminium, it may look nice, but is that going to be beneficial or not? So, and timber, is timber a better material to use? So it helps us to make choices, and then you can then redesign your building so that your building becomes less of a lower carbon footprint. So in that sense, I think it adopts the embodied carbon is that amount of element that embodies everything that is from what we call cradle to cradle, not cradle to grave.
So the carbon footprint is very important. Yes. The circular economy focuses on material flow analysis. It has, of course, a carbon component, but it looks specifically at volume of material. And how this translates into carbon is information you can use in your carbon footprint. Right. But if you look at circular economy, it's about optimizing material flow.
Okay, yeah, and I guess if you're using non-virgin materials in your, the embodied carbon will be naturally lower. I guess that's a connection probably to make. So since I don't have much time left, I'm going to now ask the panel some of the questions that have been posed. So specifically, I want to take this question up first. So the question is, there is usually an emphasis on green initiatives in the sustainability discussion. What about social aspects? How can companies drive socially responsible behavior? And I'm going to just open it up to any one of you who would like to take that question up.
I can start.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's a great question, by the way, right? Mm-hmm. Because as a sustainability practitioner, one of the things we realize is social is almost a poor cousin of environment sometimes in the sustainability conversations. But social is actually extremely critical, but at the same time also extremely complex, right? And so I think there is almost a focus on the environment, number one, because it is the big problem we need to solve for, but also because it's easier to kind of understand, right? With the social bits, who is to say what is a better social outcome versus not, and all the linkages of unintended consequences. Nonetheless, right, there are a couple of key things you can look at to understand what social good looks like, right? The first thing is supporting employment, right? We know to have resilient economies, communities, societies, it's extremely important that there is a level of financial and economic security that is available to the entire economy, right? And take a classic case, over the last couple of years, you can really begin to see the quality of national level responses, as well as business level and financial services level support across different economies and what the state of play then became, right? And so the one thing that's very important for us, at least at UOB, is understanding our role in supporting economic well-being, welfare, as well as development, and making sure that we're providing the right level of support to micro and SMEs, because they are the ones who actually then support a lot of the employment out in society. That's one thing, right? The second way that we think about social is through, and I think it was talked about by Chow Kiat just now, when you invest, you can be investing for environmental outcomes, you can also be investing for social outcomes, impact investing, right? And so we have funds that we develop and we roll out to institutional as well as retail clients that allow them to be able to participate in deploying their investments into sustainability outcomes. And some of those are social in nature. So what does social in nature mean? We have a fund in part of our business called venture management that does what we call base of the pyramid investing, right? Base of the pyramid, folks who live on $3,000 or less a year, right? And so investing into healthcare, microfinance, agriculture, education across parts of Southeast Asia, and being able to therefore lift the social outcomes, right, of these base of the pyramid type populations is another way you think about it. Now, it's important that when we go on such ventures to understand unintended consequences, right? So one of the things that is true about the social bit is because it's humanity, it gets a very complicated, right? And so care does need to be taken.
Yeah. Would you like to add on to it quickly, Constance?
Yeah, quickly. You're right, it's complex. It doesn't mean that there is no methodology out there. And we've developed the social capital protocol, mm-hmm. which actually helps dealing with those issues. And I give a quick example, which simplifies just to explain how it works. Greenfield, you can measure, if you have a development of a factory somewhere where in the countryside. you measure before you build your factory what is the literacy rate, how many hospitals, what is the life expectancy, what is the job, you know, economic power that exists there. So you do the measurement of the social construct before you build a factory. Now you build a factory, and then 5 years later, you do the same survey. And you see whether your investment has had a social impact in a community around the factory. So that's a simple example, because of course, if you do this in Singapore, it's a bit more complex. But just wanted to say that there are methodologies out there to be able to measure the social impact. And in addition to the impact, I would say it's a dependency. And that the dependency on the social that companies need. We talked about, you know, difficulties hiring people. You know, we depend on a good social fabric. We also depend on many natural resources. So the dependency, I think, is important. But you can do this on the social and environment, and you know, I encourage you to look at the social capital protocol. That is actually a methodology to look into social aspects.
I wanted to mention that I think the social capital actually gives you a license to operate. If you do not take care of the people, your customers, that's part of social, your supply chain, you don't have a license to operate in any business at all. So it is that critical. But the measurement is actually not easy. So as an example, we built buildings. If we just design a building without taking into consideration who we are designing for, then we won't attract the right tenants into our building. We do not build like ramps. So there's a certain term called universal design. It means that you have to design the building in such a way that it fits everybody, you know, not just people who are fit, but people like pregnant women, elderly people. They find it easy to get access to your building in and out. That is giving you the license to operate in the building, and that will in turn attract more tenants to come to our building. So to take that a step further, we design more than that. So for example, if you have been to one of our latest malls called Funan, hopefully if you have not, go and patronize and spend some money. You would have noticed that it is quite different from the ordinary mall. So what we have done is we wanted to create something that caters to everybody. You can, for the young people, you know, it's designed quite differently. It's the IT gadgets are there. Or if you want, you like to do some farming, you go to the urban farm upstairs. There's an urban farm, and there's also farm to table. There's a restaurant there that actually takes the produce from the farm, you know, it's a farm-to-table concept. If you like rock climbing, there's rock climbing. So we put in all these different features so as to create a better environment for the shoppers, for our tenants. There's an office building as well, so that the office tenants, they can also cycle through the mall during morning, before the mall opens. And they can. There are shower facilities for the cyclists, and then they cycle there. They go to work. So all these taken into consideration are actually social factors, social amenities. Social is designed for everybody, so that we make our mall more interesting, more our office building more attractive to tenants, and thereby improving the occupancy of our buildings and then translating to better revenue for us. So there is this chain, the value chain that you can create by increasing your social capital. Now, so the measurement of that exactly is not so well defined, but in what we then measure is higher occupancy rate, higher better revenue stream as well.
So I want to get to, because we are almost out of time, so I want to get to at least one more question, and maybe I'll get Eric to answer that question in less than a minute. So the question here is, how can companies address their scope 3 emissions, particularly with respect to setting science-based targets? I know it's a very complex question to answer in less than 1 minute, but probably Eric has some thoughts on it.
Vish, there's no way that is a 1 minute question, right? So actually, if I may, I wanted to just quickly touch on this social bit, because as I was listening to the concept of Lynette, there was one thing we didn't talk about that is quite simple and important, which is this concept of modern slavery, right? And understanding it through the procurement or supply chain, making sure that the vendors you use are selling to you using well-established labor conditions, right? And they're not, you know, modern slavery or forced labor or child labor, all that kind of stuff, I think is very important. Okay, so back to SBTI, you know, scope 3, all that kind of stuff. Vish, you are overambitious. There's no way we can crack that.
I know that.
But it is important, again, one of the things we're talking about here is to understand your supply chain, the quality of your vendors. If you're a small enterprise, it's going to be very hard for you to be able to go out and demand your vendors meet certain standards, et cetera, et cetera. But if you're a large corp, you certainly do have that ability to be able to have your suppliers sign up to particular standards of behavior. You know, even a bank like us, we're being asked to fill up supplier checklists, which is shocking. We've never had to do that because we're considered to be a supply chain to someone else already, right? So it's all about understanding your supply chain, your vendors, the sustainability practices, making the best choices possible.
I guess we are out of time, so thanks for the very interesting discussions. I guess the panel discussion actually threw up more questions than answers to, in a sense, but that's the purpose of panel discussions. And hopefully we can go and delve into one of those topics deeper in another event in the future. So I'd like to again give a big hand and thank you to Eric, Lynette, as well as Constance. Thank you so much. Yeah.
That was an engaging discussion indeed. May we now invite all the panelists on stage to return to your seats. We will now be commencing our next panel discussion on research challenges in sustainability solutions from academia. Now, we would like to welcome the panelists. The first panelist is Professor Niels de Boer, Program Director of Energy Research Institute. The next panelist is Mr. David To, CEO of Intuitive. The next panelist will be Professor Simba Chang, Associate Dean of Research of Nanyang Business School. Next, let us welcome the moderator for this session, Professor Bo Y. Fong, Deputy Dean of Nanyang Business School and Director of Information Management Research Center. Without further ado, I shall now hand over the session to the moderator. Professor Bo, please.
Thank you. All right, it's a pleasure to serve as the moderator of our last and final panel session for the day. And basically, this panel is meant to actually showcase some of the research and the thought leadership that NTU has in the area of sustainability. So as a leading research-intensive university, NTU has built its strengths in sustainability over the years. Through its achievements in research and education. So we have units across the university engaged in research in many areas, including energy, food, waste, the environment, and in also various business domains, such as in green financing, green operations, and supply chain management. So in this panel, we aim to showcase the research that is conducted by NTU's faculty and researchers and discuss how these technological developments in cutting-edge research can provide guidance to industry and firms and policymakers about how sustainable solutions can be developed and achieved. So I'm going to structure it a little bit differently from our other panels. As you know, we are all from the academic institution, and I think nothing beats the visuals. So I'm going to first invite each of the panelists to take about a few minutes to share in areas of their research and also how this might actually be potentially impact to firms. So I will introduce each of the panelists as they are coming up with their presentation, all right? So let me invite Nils to start us off. So Nils de Boer is a senior scientist in ARIAN, the Energy Research Institute for NTU. He's also the program director for the Center of Excellence for Testing and Research on Autonomous Vehicles. So very exciting areas that Nils is working on. It's also interesting that Nils not only does research, but also serves as a bridge between the researchers as well as the industry. So I think he's very well pleased to share with us a little bit on what are some of the exciting initiatives and projects that everyone is working on and how that could potentially impact us in the future. Over to you, Nils.
Okay, thank you. Before we go, maybe I start better off explaining what ARIAN is and what the Energy Research Institute is. Because we are not part of the faculty, we're not part of a college, not part of a school, we're a research institute within the university. And people like me have the luxury of spending 100% of the time on the projects and the research. That said, is we do different type of research than what is happening in the schools and colleges. And maybe, can we go next slide? So maybe a bit explaining what we are, how we set up. We're a Penn University multidisciplinary research institute within the university. We set up in around 2010 because it was realized that certain research in schools and colleges, you tend to go very deep academic, supporting PhDs, supporting master's research, but industrial projects are very wide. They're taking many aspects. So we were set up as a Penn University Research Institute. And that said, we're working very closely with schools, with colleges. Many professors are attached to our projects. And so we can do a project, for example, which might include solar technology from the School of Material Science. Business side is done by the Nanyang Business School. Electrical systems are done with the School of Electrical Electronic Engineering. School of Computer Science might provide AI. So we're working many across the university. We have three main pillars. The first one is energy systems. It's the capture and storage of energy, looking at renewables, but also fuel cells, batteries, hydrogen, and other aspects. The second pillar is grids. And while the first one is looking at capturing the energy and storing it, the second one is distributing it to where it's needed. And that is potentially a part of sustainability, because if you have very flexible ways of distributing your energy, you probably suddenly can use waste heat from one part of your facility to provide necessary reduce the energy consumption in another part of the facility. We're doing this on a very big scale at the moment in Jurong Port. And the last one is looking at the urban solutions, the use of energy. How do you minimize the use of energy? Because people talk a lot about going green with solar and wind, but actually a very, very big gains are made at the usage sites. Sustainable buildings is a big one. We're working with ultra-low energy high-rise buildings. We're working with zero energy buildings and trying to have, and we have concept designs up to 10-story zero energy buildings and positive energy buildings, buildings which produce more energy than what they use. And for example, schools can do that because they are in generally natural airflow and natural cooling. We're looking at future mobility, autonomous vehicles, electric vehicles, and we're looking at power electronics as a kind of enabler, so very technical in terms of energy use. We have two flagship projects called Eco Campus and REACH, and that's where we demonstrate all the stuff. Keep in mind, we are working on a different level than most of the other research. Academic research, we're doing through master's and PhD projects together with the schools. They're looking at the TRL, technology readiness level 1, 2, 3. We are working at applied research, taking the basic technology from the schools and colleges, maturing it to make it available to industry and to agencies and to companies. We're looking at technology readiness levels 3 to 6, but we also have an arm and Ecolapses together with the Enterprise Singapore working on that, actually commercializing this technology and looking at TRL levels 4 to 7. Next slide. So what is the two projects, flagship project? The first one was Eco Campus, started very long time ago, initially considered 2011. It had a goal of 35% reduction of energy, water, and waste as well. By 2020. We achieved that one, and it is not one big project. It's a combination of many different projects looking at many different areas. We looked at obvious ones, building technologies, cooling, insulation, heat reducing paint. Air conditioning is a big one. The biggest air conditioning problem we have is School of Chemical Engineering, where you have airflow, air circulation requirements because you have chemical labs with cooling needs. You take air from the outside, you cool it down, you put it in the chemical lab, and a few minutes later, you vent it out again because of cleanliness needs. So that's a very challenging problem. Lighting, we've looked at, and even user behavior. So many different things all coming together and many different industry partners. Next slide. And the next one is REACH. And I show here a fiction. REACH is our renewable integration, energy integration demonstrator, microgrids done on Simaco Island. Next slide, please. And that is also a consortium where we work with many different companies. One of the things is a lot of these technologies are not necessarily targeted at Singapore, but it is targeted at companies operating from Singapore, targeting markets in Southeast Asia. And it's really a set of microgrids which work together. Renewable energy we have on it, solar, wind. It's one of the few places we have an active hydrogen storage demonstrator. Again, same concept. We have many different companies all working separately, but also sometimes working together. And NTU acts here as the glue between a lot of these industrial sub-projects.
Very good. Thank you very much, Niels, for being exactly on time. Yeah. So next, let us invite Mr. David Toh. David is the CEO of Intuitive, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of NTU, responsible for commercializing the university's scientific research and incubating startups. So he's been with Intuitive for some time because before his promotion, recent promotion to CEO, he was actually the chief technology officer for Intuitive. We thought that it would be very appropriate to have David here to share with us about how NTU is commercializing its technologies, especially as many of us, of you are from the industry, and therefore I think he will play a really important role in helping us to understand what are some of the commercializable technologies that NTU produces. Yeah, David, over to you.
Thank you. Okay. Yep. So broadly speaking, Intuitive is a wholly owned subsidiary of Nanyang Technological University. Prior to me coming to NTU in 2013, I spent 20 years in banking. So I was in 10 years investment banking, 10 years on fund management. And then before that, I worked in semiconductor wafer fabrication. So my background was in engineering as well as liberal arts. And my interest has always been in the intersection between business and engineering, right? So broadly speaking, for Intuitive, the academic innovation challenge revolves around scientific discovery, looking at what the science, the science that is made or discovered by our faculty members, translating or looking at how that science can go into an engineering project. The difference between science and engineering is that engineering is deterministic, science is not. And then once we figure out how to scale that at the engineering level, then we have to wrap a business model around the engineering and then go to market. Next slide, please. So we see ourselves as really the bridge between the university and industry or the marketplace, right? So the stuff done at university generally has a very low technology readiness level. We discover things in beakers or in small quantities that we're able to synthesize. But at the corporate level, usually what is required is kilogram scale, ton scale, or very large sample sizes of the materials or close to product ready components. So our job is to interface and work with industry or the marketplace to see how we can translate some of that science into product. All right, we do this by de-risking, applying, shall we say, grants, right? Financial de-risking and technological de-risking. So financial de-risking involves the use of grants, which are given to us by the Ministry of Education and the National Research Foundation to bring the technology readiness level from rather low levels to mid and higher levels, right? So at each stage, we're de-risking for scaling, we might be de-risking for team, we might be de-risking for the marketplace, we might be de-risking for product, we might be de-risking for the C-suite that we're trying to bring on board, right? So this is a gap that Intuitive is filling in order to bring the science that is discovered at university into the marketplace. So next slide, please. Right, so some of the challenges that we face really are that at the end of the day, it's not really about the failure of technology, it's really about the failure of the business model. Because generally what we see is that the startups or the spin-offs that fail to achieve liftoff in the marketplace generally fail because they don't have the correct business model. Right, so this slide here is most appropriate because Apple was not the first company to develop the MP3 player. That credit goes to a local company called Creative Technologies, right? So the failure in Creative Technologies' ability to sustain that business model was their lack of innovation in how to resolve the problem of loading MP3 files into your player. So when Apple came along with their iPod, they introduced the iTunes Store and made it really easy to transfer and buy songs and transfer that onto your iPod. So, of course, we know the outcomes of that. And this is a key lesson that we try to impart to our researchers that, you know, the most disruptive force in business is really not about technology, but it's in the business model innovation that technology enables, right? This is what all venture capitalists are looking at. Next slide, please. So here's my final slide on some of the companies that are involved. Of course, we do on average about 15, 20 companies a year, spin-offs from faculty members. They may cover everything from robotics to advanced materials to medical devices and therapeutics. In these three categories of water, energy, and urban sustainability, I've put up some of the companies here. In water, for example, in energy, we have a company called Evercom that's worked in tandem with MAS regulations to certify green buildings so that asset owners of properties are then able to, if they're able to green mark certify their buildings, they are then able to issue green bonds, right, which are priced at lower interest rates compared to your regular bonds. Right, so this company, Evercom, works with a number of Japanese and I believe local banks
to help property owners get their building certified. So the rest of these companies here, they're involved in anywhere from, you know, transformers, robotics for looking at building and construction maintenance, paintings. Then we have another company I didn't post up here, which is involved in carbon nanotube or carbon nanofiber concrete, which is used for the making of UHPC, ultra high performance concrete that goes into buildings and infrastructure. So that company, you probably won't see them much in Singapore because their go-to market is actually in the US, because Singapore is really not really a significant market for some of these companies. So you might not hear some of these companies, but their really go-to market strategy is in the big markets overseas. Okay, so with that, I will wrap up my presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, David. Very glad to see that we have so many up-and-coming companies using and leveraging on NTU technologies. Just now, I think David talked about the importance of the business models. And I think this is a perfect fit with what Prof Vish is going to talk about. We're probably familiar with Prof Vish. He just moderated our previous panel. So Vish is also a professor of the Nanyang Business School for the Division of Information Technology and Operations Management. And he also serves as the director of the Center for Business Sustainability. And Vish actually works on a lot of very interdisciplinary research, and he explores about how the business models needs to change and be extended when we talk about various technologies in that sustainability space. So Vish, over to you.
Thank you, Waifong. So David mentioned about the basic research being funded by the agencies like NRF and so on. And then I guess by the time it's ready to go towards a pathway of commercialization to eventually reach TRL 8, and there has to be things like proof of concept and MVP, minimum viable product, and so on. But even before that, some of the research issues being addressed are very challenging, and there might be multiple pathways. And even before we get to that stage, you need business inputs and insights. And that's where, and this is something being asked for by the funding agencies as well, and that's where some of our research lies in. So next slide, please. So essentially the question we are trying to address is how to evolve the pathway from fundamental research to eventual commercialization, but before the steps that Intuitive or David would take. So it's maybe it's not even TRL1, it's probably what I would call TRL minus 1 or 0, that probably doesn't exist, but to go up to TRL 3 or 4, you have alternative technologies. How do you evaluate them? So some of the methodologies that we bring to the table are life cycle analysis, total supply chain value assessment, what I call total supply chain value assessment, techno-economic analysis, as well as business model design and analysis. And I might, if I have time, talk a little bit about green operations and supply chain. So let me illustrate this with one example. Next slide, please. So this is actually a project that we just got funded. It's called Proteins for Singapore. It's a collaborative effort between TUM in Munich, NTU through the umbrella of CREATE. So the project is actually for vertical farming of proteins. So we have the 30 by 30 challenge for food. And the larger picture is by 2050, there's going to be a serious food shortage. And Singapore wants to make sure that food security is an issue that we address well. So when you look at food security, it's not enough that we just do vertical farming of greens. We need something more substantial if you want to eventually get there. So the fundamental research that is being looked at by the NTU's chemical engineers and the food scientists from both NTU and TUM is how can we grow proteins like algae or soy through vertical farming? Of course, it's a lab experiment, so we're not building a building to do the vertical farming. It's the experiments are done in a container. But they need information as to alternative pathways within the research itself. And eventually the policymakers and the researchers need information as to how can we take the next step before we eventually go to a intuitive to take the pathway to commercialization. So we are actually going to do life cycle analysis of different sources of proteins, The plan is to develop new holistic LCA methodology for food supply chain that incorporates supply chain resiliency, food security, societal impacts, and so on, and process modeling optimization. So let me also give another example. That's the next slide. So the other big question is in terms of alternative pathways for Energy Singapore's pathway to decarbonization. And we all know that we don't have renewable sources within the island. So unlike for water and food and so on, where we are trying to build in security and internal sources, for energy, we need to look at possibly importing green hydrogen from Australia or importing grid energy from Malaysia. So this is actually a project that we are currently still working on for proposal grant, along with researchers from ERIEN as well as from TUM, looking at the pathways. And one of the specific things we are looking at is Singapore as a hydrogen hub. And again, this will involve a combination of a techno-economic analysis, business analysis, and LCA. I just want to talk about one more thing before my time ends up. So since you mentioned about business models, so I guess as researchers, we want to also look at business models from an academic perspective. So next slide, please. And I think it's mentioned here. So the particular piece of work, this has been done under, again, another CREATE project, looking specifically at rooftop solar adoption. And the findings of this research is to say that sometimes one can frame a business model design problem itself as a pricing problem. So for example, in this particular piece of research, the insights we get is that you can have a leasing versus power purchase agreement, right? So those are two strategies. But the way to look at it ultimately is that leasing is a sort of it's a two-part tariff in the sense that there is leasing where you pay commit to pay a fixed rental upfront every month, whereas power purchase agreement is actually variable payment based on the actual amount of renewable energy generated. But you could actually have a hybrid different pricing strategy depending on what the customer requires. So those are kinds of analysis that we can bring to bear in analyzing business models using game theory and mathematics to do it. Maybe I should stop here and let you have the time. So.
Okay, thank you, Vish. You shared a lot about some interesting projects. It's very glad to see that we are really integrating what we know from business with technology to think about not just technological development, but to make sure that these technologies can also be commercialized. So next, may I invite Professor Simba Chang. Simba is the Associate Dean of Research for NBS. He's also a professor of finance. And so he does lots of interesting research. He specializes in corporate finance. More recently, his work has also gone into green finance and sustainable finance. So I think we're very excited to hear not just from the technology side, but also in terms of the research that our business school is engaging in and how that can potentially inform future, green economy. Over to you.
Okay, thank you, Wai-Fang. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to basically share several ongoing projects being conducted at MBS about sustainable finance. We all know that sustainable finance is about integrating ESG into financing and investment decisions, but I guess given the time I have, so I'll focus on the environmental side only. So the next slide, please. So we have a large group of researchers at MBS conducting research on climate risks, first of all. In particular, we're focusing on how to measure and manage climate risk. We all know that climate risk is an important issue. It's an economic risk arising from climate change. And then you affect really companies' profit and firm value. But very important question is, how can we measure a company's exposure to climate risk at company level for each firm? I think this is an important question to address if you want to manage climate risk in financial market. So here we are pioneering the use of so-called computational linguistic tools and also machine learning techniques to analyze basically companies' CSR report and also their conference call transcripts and also their management discussion in the annual report. So we are conducting textual analysis to extract important information so that we can measure each company's climate risk exposure. Using this measure, we can expand existing asset pricing models so that we can price climate risk properly in financial market. I think our research will be very useful for actually our investors, for portfolio managers, and maybe for even for policymakers. And our we actually have very strong insurance actuarial science group at Nanyang Business School, and they are conducting research about using very advanced statistical models, such as neural network-based models to price weather risk. It's very high dimensional, very difficult to deal with. And in addition, my colleague Chi Fei and his co-authors actually are looking at how regulatory risk related to climate change can affect bond pricing and credit rating. And they have written a paper which is well cited and has won many awards. Okay, next slide, please. In the second area, actually, we're looking at the determinants and the consequences of corporate environmental responsibility, or CER. So for determinants, actually, they're about how we can actually incentivize companies to be more environmentally responsible. So we have identified a number of factors. Some of them are discouraging, some of them are actually quite encouraging. So for the discouraging ones, for example, we find bank deregulation and labor costs, and also corporate taxes are negative factors for CER. But also have positive factors, such as internal control over financial reporting, and institutional ownership and media disclosure. Especially, I'm writing a paper about this internal control over financial reporting. So we are looking at, basically, we use toxic chemical released by all the companies in the US as a measure for corporate environmental performance. And we identify 650 toxic chemicals. And then we realized that for companies, internal control over financial reporting, basically a very high quality internal control can enable company to come up with very timely and accurate information, which is actually very critical for companies' environmental performance and management. On the consequence side, actually, it's about why actually a company can do well by doing good. So identify the these consequences using our empirical analysis. For example, we find that more environmentally responsible companies tend to have more durable customer-supply relationship, and they actually can afford to borrow more money from capital market. In other words, corporate environmental responsibility can enhance companies' debt capacity. Especially, they can get more money from banks, because we may now know banks nowadays are more willing to lend money to environmentally responsible borrowers. Next slide. And then in the next area, we are looking at financial innovation. So how to finance sustainable investment. We all know these green bonds and sustainability-linked bonds and social bonds, for example. Especially for green bond, I want to highlight one of the project actually my colleagues is working on by Tao Chen. He actually find that he looked at the provision of green loan. Essentially, he finds that while we all know that ladies actually are more environmentally responsible than men, this is not a gender discrimination. It's actually well-established scientific fact. But unfortunately, we don't really have all the banks with female CEOs. Otherwise, we'll be living in maybe a better place. But among all the male CEOs for banks, those with daughters actually are more socially or environmentally responsible. They are more likely to provide green loans to borrowing firms, and they are also enabling these borrowing firms to be more environmentally responsible. I guess I have a time for the last slide quickly. So this is a cross-disciplinary effort with my colleague at SPMS and social science, and we are working on a project to use crowdfunding to finance plastic upcycling, and then we have the technology to use photocatalysts to break down the plastic waste into very useful chemicals. So this is so-called upcycling, and we are looking at basically a public fundraising campaign. Hopefully, we can raise 3.4 million in 5 years, and so we can upgrade the technological readiness level from 3 to 6. So overall, this is the basic message is we have a large group of researchers doing a research about sustainable finance at Nanyang Business School, and we are tackling globally challenging issues such as climate change and plastic waste management. Hopefully, we can have your support for our research. Thank you. Sorry, I'm running a little over time.
Thank you, Simba. Very interesting research. Very glad to hear the impact that females have in sustainability, right? Creating and continuing the sustainability journey. So I guess I would like to explore a few issues with the panelists. Thank you for your wonderful sharing. I think that really gave us a very good sense of what various units in NTU are doing. Certainly, we are not capturing everything here. There are lots of people working on food, water, waste, for example, and circular economy, which is not represented on the panel. But I would like to explore a little bit about the challenges that each of the groups face in doing research in this sustainability area. So perhaps we could start with you, Niels. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we have a number of challenges in sustainability, and in general, we do very well locally on our projects. So maybe a little background. All our people are employed based on projects we get in. We get funding in from projects, projects-based funding in general, and that's how we employ our staff. That said, most of our funding is on reimbursement basis. If it's for government, if it's an industrial project, then our funding gets based on the project funding. Again, it might have a government component associated to it. That works reasonably well. We're running sometimes into some issues with keeping that sustainable. One of the challenges sometimes we have is that we mentioned before SMEs. If we want to really go sustainability, we can't ignore the SMEs. But for us, SMEs are not easy to work with. It's challenging to work with SMEs. First, to be frank, this much smaller company, their financial resources are less. So in general, you need to be very realistic what you can do with the funding available. Secondly is we're running quite often into issues that at the end of the project, this SME has a completely different understanding of what they would receive than we would have. There is quite a big gap between understanding what an SME, what a project in NTU will do for a company. If you look at an SME versus a larger company. So if we work with larger industries, internationally established company, MNCs, we have hardly any issues. SMEs, we quite regularly have issues, so there is a lack of understanding there. So SMEs are very challenging to work for. The other area which we have a little bit sometimes a challenge with is we are working also with companies who want to do sustainability-based projects, but not deploy it in Singapore. So, for example, you might work with a hotel developer who is looking at making their resort in Bali or Langkawi or Phuket more green and more free. It's hard to get funding for that because one of the funding quite often needs to be supported by an agency, and you go to the agency, we want to do this, and they go, that's overseas, that is not in Singapore, why should I support it? Which is a bit ironic because EDB is encouraging these companies to set up the hub to target the rest of Southeast Asia in Singapore. So quite often it can be resolved, we need to go back to the EDB, but that is sometimes challenging. Often it gets resolved, but not all the time. So that is sometimes an issue. And that's also with the REITs I showed before. We have on Samarco the renewable, the microgrid center. A lot of these companies are MNCs which have come to Singapore because they see us as a safe place to do business and target the rest of Southeast Asia. They want to have an R&D component in the region because we understand the regional needs. That said, is when we get quite often the problem, why do you want to do a microgrid? Singapore have a good grid, it's not needed. Mm-hmm. But we are supporting companies operating in Singapore who are targeting the rest of Southeast Asia. So that is sometimes a bit of a challenge.
Mm. Interesting. So indeed, what I hear is really the alignment of expectations, right? Both between the company and us, especially for SMEs, and also how to deal with development of technology here and yet deployment of these technologies overseas, which is probably very common among a lot of what the organizations are looking at. For David, I would like to really understand a little bit about the, I guess you face lots of challenges, right? Because there's lots of a great gap, as you mentioned, that chasm between industry and academia, which can be viewed as very ivory tower. But yet we see some success, right, in terms of what you have shown. So I'm just wondering, are there certain, while there are challenges, are there some ways that you've seen that is effective in resolving some of these challenges in crossing this valley of death?
Yeah, thanks for the question. So I think generally the office of Intuitive, we've made a conscious decision to hire people from industry. So in the team that we've built up, we have people from, you know, for technology licensing, they're engineers, but they're engineers who worked in industry. So rule number one when I joined the company was that we didn't hire people by degrees, but hired people by experience and skill sets. The other thing, the other component is the venture build team, which we've built up recently. The venture build team is to help our faculty spin-offs, startups. So the venture build team, again, comprises of people with base level engineering skill sets like myself, but who've worked in banking, who've worked in McKinsey Consulting, who've worked in Lux Research Consulting, who worked in corporate multinationals, who know how to ideate from product, from a piece of paper designed into a business unit that's gone to market, right? So experienced people like that who've done things, and we try to hire people who have very diverse backgrounds, because fundamentally what we think is that the team is stronger with people who have different ideas, who can come up with out-of-the-box thinking, rather than hire homogeneously from academia. So we generally have not hired people from academia just because we needed the skill sets of industry, whether it's banking, consulting, or multinationals.
So sounds like you have built a team which essentially serves as the bridge, yeah, between the academia as well as the industry, and hopefully helps to bridge any sort of alignment of expectations as required between the two. All right, so maybe Simba, could you also share a little bit, because you're doing really important research looking at green and sustainable finance. You see lots of impacts. What impacts such work, as well as what are some of the impacts of such financing? So I'm just wondering, of course, there are the challenges that you usually face in terms of doing research, but in this particular sustainability area, what kind of challenges do you specifically face in this research domain?
Okay, so I think I've been doing research in the on this topic for quite many years. Mm-hmm. But I think the biggest challenge to me is always the measurement issue, especially when it comes to, for example, environmental and social issues. Actually, relatively speaking, environmental performance is actually relatively easier, because at least we can look at, for example, CO2 emission, we can look at toxic chemical releases, for example. But for just now in the previous session, the panelists actually discussed how important social impacts actually are, but how actually we can quantify them. This is actually a huge, hugely challenging issue. So that's why I think if we just look at the existing, for example, ESG ratings and CSR ratings, many companies are working on that, providing this ratings, but according to our research, we find that the correlation among these ratings actually are very low, so they are not really that correlated. Mm. So in the end, the customers are confused, investors are confused, also researchers are very confused as well. So this is basically the challenges. But to me, I think that maybe the remedies or the solutions could be, first of all, we should have more effort from government to encourage disclosure. Disclosure is a hugely important issue. Encourage a company to disclose their carbon footprint, environmental performance, and social impact. so that you know investors can have something to refer to, and they can construct more accurate ratings or indices to quantify this performance. And the second maybe solution is technology, as you just mentioned. I think maybe this financial technology, big data or AI technique can really help here to really help us to extract important information to measure the ESG performance so that you know all of us can make a more informed decision. So.
So thanks for that. I guess, Simba, you're highlighting the importance of measurements, right? Because earlier, I think Constant also mentioned the importance of measuring to gauge the impact. And I guess being able to do it across organizations in a very systematic manner and using analytics is really one particular approach that your team has taken and is seeing some outputs and impact from that. Yeah. So Vish, could you share a little bit as well? Because you did mention about how you were working on very interesting projects to look at business models or looking at how you could help them to think about a commercialization for something which hasn't really been, I guess, sculpted very clearly yet. So there must be lots of issues with that. Could you share with us how you tackle that?
So, I guess interdisciplinary research is not new. So especially in the engineering school, people collaborate between medical school and engineering and different branches of engineering. But the difference there is normally each person brings one skill set. So my understanding is maybe there is a measurement issue and you need a measurement device. Mm-hmm. And then there is a particular technology available in physics or electrical engineering and they marry together and things work. So. They have their own expertise and they don't necessarily need to understand the other parts of the problem context. But when you have, and in fact, I think the business school getting involved in the kind of research I mentioned is relatively new around the world itself, because typically the business folks do their stuff. And if at all there's a connection between the engineering school, it's probably at the level of research in entrepreneurship, startups and so on. So here, I mentioned one project on food, proteins for Singapore. The other one is on hydrogen hub. So first of all, there has to be a deep level of expertise built by people from my side. Mm-hmm. And the engineers or the scientists have to see a need to actually teach us, because they have to see value in us in terms of what we bring to the table. That's the first challenge. Mm-hmm. Second is in terms of the research manpower, because again, LCA as a technology is not new, it's been there for a long time, but it's a technology that has existed more among the consultants and practitioners. Mm-hmm. And all over the world, the number of LCA experts in academia is actually quite limited. So, and it's not enough that you know LCA, you need to understand how to apply it in a different context. So that's a challenge as well. So when you look at business models again, you might come with some background about looking at business models, but you need to contextualize it to the particular problem. So that those are different kinds of challenges in terms of interdisciplinary research, which probably is applicable here. But I believe that it's very important, and I think it's probably because of the effort of the funding agencies as well as the universities to say, let the business school get involved, because that's a way we can actually answer the big questions. The other big challenge is when you look at things 30, 40 years from now, making model estimates. For example, today people will say that, solar panels are comparable to coal with carbon capture and storage in certain parts of India, for example. Mm. But when you have to look at what will be the price of food 30 years from now, you need to take a leap of faith. You cannot just rely on linear forecasts that are available. How can you help the policymakers make a decision to say that, we are going to actually go big in vertical farming in Singapore? In a sense, such a leap of faith was made earlier when we decided that we're going to invest big in water technologies because we wanted to become self-sufficient. So even though desalination technology or other technologies are much more expensive, the policymakers are convinced. So that's a kind of a research challenge, because you cannot just rely on models. Mm. You need to bring to bear again, it's an estimation issue. How do you actually, it becomes sort of a combination of hard sciences and soft sciences. so that you can actually inform the policymakers. Mm. Right,
so. Okay. Yeah. So thanks for sharing. I guess it's really trying to bridge the gap between what we cannot really see yet, but yet we need to make some forecasts so that it can help the policymakers to make decisions about what to invest in the future. Yeah. So let us switch tack a little bit, and I would like to explore a little bit more about beyond NTU's technologies. What are some of the key exciting research out there which we should be paying attention to and we should be really keeping our eyes on? So maybe we could start with you, Niels. What are some very promising avenues?
Yeah, we're looking at a number of things, of course. And if you say what's beyond NTU, we don't look at it yet, but it's coming, is hydrogen. Mm-hmm. Hydrogen is coming up big time. It has been on and off. NTU has been looking at hydrogen fuel cells for 20 plus years. Mm-hmm. But people are starting to look at hydrogen in a different way now, and in a much larger way, and that people started to think big, and it actually might make sense now. So that is really something which is interesting and could be a big, great opportunity. There are lots of technical challenges still with it, and also business challenges.
Mm. Okay, David?
Okay, so I deal with the entire university, so I see a plethora of interesting technologies, and being an engineer myself, I'm actually very excited about the next 20 years because, you know, everything, one day it's a project in synthetic biology looking at producing alternative fuels using bacteria. Another day it's looking at different chemistries of batteries, electric batteries. There are, you know, four principal components in batteries. You have your cathode, anode, separator, and your electrolyte. You know, so if you look at all the companies in the world, there's innovations at every single component in that space, right? So you have lithium sulfide batteries, you have iron oxide batteries, you have anode-less batteries, you have solid-state electrolyte batteries coming, which means that actually if you're a buyer of an EV vehicle in the next 5 years, you know, historically in the past when my parents bought a car, the number one spec that most people bought their cars on was the miles per gallon spec. Nobody looked at anything else because that, you know, I grew up in the 1973 to 1979 oil crisis. And so at that time when people bought cars, they always looked at MPG, right? Miles per gallon. In the next 5 years, as people transition from gasoline into electric cars, everybody's gonna look at those specs. You know, the specs are going up right now. You have 300 miles range right now, standard for Tesla, that's going to double and perhaps go up to 1,000 miles, which is equivalent to 2,000 km per charge, right? Then you have fast charging technology coming as well. So aside from the other one, hydrogen is the other one that's fascinating because, you know, aircraft probably going to be powered by hydrogen in the future when you fly from Singapore to London, simply because it's just uneconomical to fly tons of, you know, constant weight of batteries from Singapore to London, right? If you're flying batteries, you're essentially transporting batteries from Singapore to London, because if you fly on jet kerosene, as you approach London, you're at half tank or less than half tank, one third tank. So that means your fuel efficiency increases with range. But for batteries, you get none of that efficiency improvement with range. So hydrogen is the solution for long distance trucking, for long distance flying, for shipping, you know. And then places like MIT in alternative energies looking at nuclear fusion, right? So nuclear fusion is much safer than nuclear fission, which currently powers most of the nuclear power plants. And then not only do we have nuclear fusion, but we have mini nuclear plants as well. Alternative energies alternative energies for solar, different advanced materials like perovskite, building integrated solar photovoltaics, where you can actually create a film that goes onto a window of a building that generates electricity. Films that do carbon capture. I can go on and on.
Yeah, it sounds like you can go on and on. Right. Thanks, David. So I think a lot of food for thought. Thanks, David, for at least coming up with a list that's top of your mind. For those interested in the rest of the list, please approach David later. All right. Maybe we move on to Simba. Would you like to share what's the next frontier you think could really be exciting for research in sustainability and finance?
Okay, I think the key word is still technology. I believe the next exciting research area will be the combination of financial technology and sustainability. Apart from the measurement issues that we talk about, we know that technology can play an important role, but I can think of at least quite a few other things using financial technology. For example, you know, when we talk about this green bond, the green financing, the major challenge is we know that the proceeds should be invested into environmental friendly project, but how can you basically ensure a company will do that after they got the proceeds? So it needs some monitoring mechanism, but we know monitoring is costly. A technology can help. For example, if we can have this use of proceeds or KPIs programmed into smart contracts, and then all these things will be executed automatically, so that then the cost of green bond insurance will be greatly reduced. And this will, of course, stimulate the company's environmental performance. And we can have, for example, when people talk about carbon market, carbon credit, all these trading issues. If we can have this, all the carbon market, carbon trading on, distributed data infrastructure, this is, again, new financial technology, and then, of course, the trading will be greatly facilitated. Mm. And we'll also talk about, for example, crowdfunding and some platform. For example, if we want to direct the capital into environmentally friendly project, maybe we can utilize small retail investors' money. So maybe we can design robot, for example, advisors to really advise small investors to actually really invest small amount of money into climate-friendly projects. But we can put this money together, can make a big impact. Mm. I think technology will play a very important role.
All right, thanks for sharing. So basically, you believe the future is in track and trace systems, yeah? Exactly. That can really help with tracking after the green financing, and the role of fintech sounds like you really believe in that as well, yeah? Vish, you have the last words?
Yeah, so some of the things I wanted to say, Niels and David already mentioned. So I'll just mention two things, hydrogen again, but in a different context, plus circular economy. So hydrogen, so most of the discussion about hydrogen is mostly now about as an energy source, I mean, basically the last mile source as such. But I believe we still need downstream chemical industries, oil and gas, for most of the things that we use day to day. And even though we might go to alternative fuels, we still need the oil and gas industry, but we cannot use oil. So eventually there has to be research on using hydrogen as a feedstock along with captured carbon to run the entire downstream chemical and oil and gas rather than using oil and gas. So that's the big, huge research challenge going ahead. The other one is there's been a lot of discussion about circular economy, but there are very few companies actually that do remanufacturing, and some of the companies that do remanufacturing do it because it's actually profitable, the Caterpillars of the world, where they actually, but they sell it still as a remanufactured product where they take the things and combine it. But the dream eventually will be that we don't just use non-virgin materials that are recycled back all the way, but maybe in a version 18 of a product, we actually use components as is from version 12 of the product, right? And I mean, when I exchanged this idea with engineers in Arian, say 5 years ago, they say it's not doable because by then, the product life cycle would have changed so much, nobody will want to do it. So there's been a lot of research articles to say that remanufacturing or circular economy doesn't pay. But things are changing so quickly because circular economy is one big piece of the puzzle. We have energy efficiency. Until we really find alternative sources of energy, we still need to take the circular economy discussion much, much further, right? So, but I'm talking about it from a fundamental researcher's point of view, right? Mm.
So. Okay. Niels, you wanted to respond, yeah? I can
yeah.
see you.
No, I agree with the remanufacturing. I've seen it. I've seen examples of what Caterpillar is doing. It's impressive. Mm-hmm. It's very impressive what they're doing. So that one I definitely agree with. It is done in certain areas, but not in many.
I'd like to see a company like Apple do it. I mean, that's what I said. When Apple is planning for iPhone, they should be thinking about iPhone, iPhone 18 now, when they're thinking about iPhone 12. Mm-hmm. And so we talk about modular design, but modular design is always talked about modular design across space, meaning across different mm-hmm. models. Mm-hmm. But you should be thinking about modular design across time mm-hmm. so that you can actually, and then of course you need to have business models in place. Servicization where we don't actually own the phones. Companies are already doing it. I mean, I just spoke to a company in the tire sector. Mm-hmm. They're doing it. Printers, cartridges and so on. Mm-hmm. And they don't just use it as a model to bring back. They also try to use the mm-hmm. as much of the old components as possible. So mm-hmm. that's, it's not easy to do. If you talk to Constantine, he'll say that you need to bring the entire ecosystem partners into place. Mm-hmm. But that's a huge opportunity.
Yep. So indeed, good food for thought, because it really suggests that we might need to rethink the entire business model, how the ecosystem works, how product designs work, not just depending on technology, but also make use of the various business models designed to supplement the technology solutions that we have out there. Yes. All right, so I think I have reached the end of our panel. I'd like to applaud our panelists for spending time with us and sharing their insights and sharing their thoughts and sharing the very exciting research that each of them are working on. Yeah, let's.
Thank you, Professor Bo. That was an insightful discussion indeed. May we now invite all panelists on stage to return to your seats. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have now come to the end of NBS Business Conference 2022. Thank you very much for taking time out this afternoon to be with us. Stay well, stay safe, and hope to see you soon.